Well, good evening, everyone. Let's call to order our Lynnwood City Council business meeting for this evening, Monday, May 13th, 2019. And Councilmember Hurst, if you would lead us in the flag salute.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Could we have the roll call, please?
Mayor Smith?
Here.
Council President Goodwin?
Present.
Council Vice President Frizzell?
Here.
Councilmember Sessions?
Here.
Councilmember Ross?
Here.
Councilmember Cotton?
Happy to be here.
Councilmember Hurst?
Here.
Councilmember Sutton?
Hello.
Council is present, Mayor.
Thank you. Moving on to item 30, the approval of the minutes. Councilmember Cotton?
Thank you, Your Honor. I move the council approve the following minutes. Work session, April 17th, 2019. Business meeting, April 22nd, 2019. Special work session, April 29th, 2019. And work session, May 6th, 2019.
Second.
Thank you. Are there any changes or amendments? Councilmember Sutton?
Thank you, Mayor.
In reading the minutes from April 17, line 32, I would like to add that I also gave a report regarding the Snohomish County tomorrow. And that would be on line 33.
And what page, Councilmember Sutton?
30A.
30A-2.
What? I'm sorry, what line is it now that I found it? It's 33.
Okay.
So you're adding and Snohomish County tomorrow.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Anything else? All right. All those in favor of approving the minutes, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposition? Thank you. It's been a long time since we've been at a business meeting, I feel like. So I have several messages from the mayor tonight. We've had quite a bit of excitement over the past couple of weeks. Lynnwood turned 60, and we had a series of ribbon cuttings and events to commemorate that. We hosted our annual volunteer recognition celebration. We hosted a joint board and commission meeting and had some great engagement with our advisory board members. And I'd like to just take the opportunity to thank our city staff members for all the work that they did behind the scenes to make sure that all these events and recognitions went off without a hitch. We've been moving forward our race and social equity work. Our Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion Commission hosted a great workshop at the annual Step Up Conference, and we had several city staff attend. And just last week, our city's leadership team had an unconscious bias training, and we're looking at bringing back this training for hiring managers and frontline staff. Last week, we celebrated two regional service providers. I attended the Child Strive annual luncheon, and they do tremendous work supporting families with young children to succeed. And then we also celebrated the grand opening of the new North Point, Washington. It's actually in Edmonds, but they are a drug rehab facility, and we really need their services in our community. And finally, this week, we're celebrating Deputy Chief Brian Stanifer, who after 31 years of service to the Lynnwood Police Department is retiring this Friday. Deputy Chief Stanifer has been an incredible leader, not only at the Lynnwood Police Department, but for our entire region. He's a true professional, and he is leaving this place better off. And I'll dearly miss him, but wish him the best of luck on the next chapter of his life. So with that, we'll move into our citizen comments. I will take those who have signed up on the citizen comments sheet first. You'll come to the podium, state your name and address, and you'll be afforded 3 minutes to speak to council and myself. So the first one up is Rosa Antoine.
Good evening, Rosa Antoine from the, I want to say Shag, but Destinations. Up on the hill. Anyway, I just wanted to let you know that we met with two gentlemen from the Public Works, and and we had a really, really good meeting with them. They came and looked over our request for a crosswalk, and I think it's going to happen, which is very exciting, and we're all just really happy about that, and it'll take a little while, but thank you for sending them over. That's about all I have to say. Thank you.
Thank you. Steve Greenbaum.
I think my address is on file by now. Stephen Greenbaum. I'll try to do this in 3 minutes. If not, I'll tag team and come back up later. I want to talk to you today about something that I witnessed when I was walking around the city of Lynnwood, which is a couple of weeks ago, watching some weeds being taken care of by the city of Lynnwood and spraying on either Roundup or glyphosate or whatever it is that you are, permutations of that that's going on. I spoke about this several years ago. At that point, the city of Lynnwood was going to look into how much they were using, whether they could use less. And the bottom line is it's still using Roundup. And I've sent a couple of articles to a few council members. I'm sure they'll be happy to share them if you wish, about cities that are banning it, counties around the country that are banning it. And I would ask the city of Lynnwood, I know you have a lot on your plates, this is one more thing, take care of it, to look into it, to get rid of it, and to stop using it in public parks, in public walkways, anywhere in the city of Lynnwood. I would ask you to do this first and foremost for the health and welfare of the citizens of the city of Lynnwood. If that's not enough incentive, today there was yet another court decision, and the decision was in favor of the plaintiffs for $2 billion. Now, immediately everyone said, oh, that'll be cut down. It'll be probably, and it will be. It'll cut down from $2 billion to $1 billion, probably only $500 million. So that may be all that it'll cost the city of Lynnwood if the city of Lynnwood continues to use this and someone finally holds the city liable for putting its citizens in jeopardy. But before you even consider that, I would hope you would simply consider the health and welfare of the city of Lynnwood and ban the use of this weed killer. Now, if you can't figure out what else to do with killing weeds, think of how much it will cost if you don't and you're sued. Take a neighborhood, take care of weeds. If you don't want to do that, as was suggested to me, to suggest to you this evening how I take care of weeds, I take care of weeds by using salt and vinegar, neither of which will kill people or animals or pollute the sound. So I would ask you to look into this, and more than look into it, because that always can go down a very long, unfortunate road. Act, please, for the welfare of the city of Lynnwood. Act. Thank you.
Anybody else like to speak tonight in citizen comments? We have two public hearings, so if you have comments for public hearings, please save it for that time. Ted Heichel.
Ted Heichel, 3820, 191st Place Southwest in Lynnwood for 47 years, and four more years in an apartment up on 176, so I'm up to 51 years. I wasn't thinking of speaking at this time, later in the meeting tonight, but first of all, I would like to say Brian Stanifer has been an outstanding member of the Lynnwood staff, and I certainly, over the years, have known his contributions to the city, and I wish him well in retirement. It's a wonderful thing. You can do a lot more in retirement, however, than you ever thought you could. I was was of the opinion that the city of Lynnwood had banned Roundup for use in our parks, and I'm not sure what the gentleman saw being sprayed, but I do know, for instance, on 40th Avenue West, we have ditches and we have tons of dandelions coming into bloom, which my younger son, when he was very young, used to call figgy fizzes. So figgy fizzes are starting to blow up the hill into all of our yards, causing a problem. The other thing, I was looking at some of the old budgets of the city of Lynnwood, and I noticed that in the 2015-2016 budget, there was $19 million set aside for fire service for the biennium. In the 17-18 budget, it was raised over 25%, up to $24 million. I'm not sure what that $5 million extra was for the next 2 years. I don't think it was particularly staff. But now, with $7 billion worth of property value in the city of Lynnwood, the fire service is going to receive $14 million for 1 year, so in other words, a biennium of $28 million. And my question is the city of Lynnwood going to receive $28 million worth of service from the fire department now? I leave you with that question.
Others who'd like to speak this evening? All right, thank you. We'll move on to our presentations and proclamations. And as Councilmember Cotton moves down to the podium, he will be reading the proclamation for Bike Everywhere Month.
Thank you, Your Honor. Proclamation of the City of Lynnwood, recognition of Bike Everywhere Month. Whereas the bicycle is an economical, healthy, convenient, and environmentally sound form of transportation, both for commuting and errands, and an excellent tool for recreation and enjoyment of Washington State's scenic beauty, and whereas throughout the month of May, the residents of Lynnwood and its visitors will experience the joys of bicycling through educational programs, community events, community rides, or by simply getting out and going for a ride, and whereas the City of Lynnwood staff will be participating in the Bike Everywhere Day on Friday, May 17th, and Bike to Health South County Rides organized by the Cascade Bicycle Club and starting in Lynnwood, Malik Terrace, and Edmonds and throughout the summer, and whereas Cascade Bicycle Club, Washington Bikes, schools, parks, and recreation departments, police departments, public health districts, hospitals, companies, and civic groups will be promoting bicycling through the month of May 2019, and whereas Lynnwood's Healthy Communities Action Plan identifies an active living goal to make it easy and safe for residents to be physically active daily, and whereas the Lynnwood is actively working to develop a complete streets policy that ensures public streets provide space for all users, motor vehicles, pedestrians, and bicyclists, and whereas Lynnwood is working collaboratively with neighboring cities to complete missing links of the bicycle network throughout South Snohomish County through the Bike to Health program, and whereas Cascade Bicycle Club and many other groups mentioned above are also promoting greater public awareness of bicycling and bicycle safety and education to reduce collisions, injuries, and fatalities and improve health and safety for everyone on the road. Now, therefore, be it resolved that we, the Mayor and City Council of the City of Lynnwood, do hereby proclaim May 2019 as Bike Everywhere Month in Lynnwood and call on all community members to join us in this special observance. Signed today, Mayor Nicholas Smith and Benjamin Goodwin, City Council President.
Thank you. Is there anyone here to receive that proclamation? All right. Thank you, Councilmember Cotton.
Thank you, Mayor. I would just note, too, I think Verdant Health is also one of our good partners on some of the Bike to Health stuff, too. So thank you to Verdant Health if you're out there.
Thank you. Our next proclamation is Historic Preservation Month. And Councilmember Hurst will move to the podium.
so I'm going to read a proclamation on Historic Preservation Month. Is there anybody from the History and Heritage Board that's here? Or? Want to get her? Okay. Okay. Well, I'll just... Let me tell you a little bit. I do. I have a master's in history from the University of North Carolina, Chapel Hill. BA in history from the UW.
Oh, here she goes.
And we were just talking about historic preservation, so if nobody shows up, you're going to come up here. Because we were talking about it.
See?
Not that, because of the... I'm digging myself deeper.
All right, here we are. Would you like to join Councilmember Hurst at the podium? Chris? Yeah,
Chris, you get to be with me. Okay. All right. So, okay, so I'll read the proclamation, and then if you want to say something afterwards, that'd be great. All right. So, proclamation, City of Lynnwood, recognition of Historic Preservation Month. Whereas historic preservation is relevant for communities across the nation, both urban and rural, and for Americans of all ages, all walks of life, and all ethnic backgrounds, and whereas historic preservation is a valuable tool that helps to maintain our community character, foster local pride, revitalize neighborhoods, and enhance overall livability. And whereas each year in the summer months, Lynnwood's History and Heritage Board and our partners at Heritage Park host History and Heritage Days to highlight local history, and whereas we recognize the importance to celebrate the role of history in our lives and the contributions made by the individuals dedicated to preserving the tangible characteristics of the heritage that has helped shape us all as people, now therefore be it resolved that we, the Mayor and City Council of the City of Lynnwood, do hereby proclaim May 2019 as Historic Preservation Month in Lynnwood and call on all community members to join us in this special observance. Signed, Nicola Smith, Mayor, and Benjamin Goodwin, City Council President. And Chris, if you want to speak a little bit.
Sure. Hi, Chris Donovan. I'm History and Heritage Board. I'd just like to thank the council and the community for all of the support we've gotten, especially Shannon. And let you know there are spaces available on the history board if anyone's interested. And even if you're not, but you'd like to learn a little bit more about Lynnwood's history, come on down to Heritage Park and you might be surprised at how interesting it is. So, thank you.
Thank you.
We get to go up front.
Glad you made it, Chris.
And our third proclamation for this evening is Arts Education Month, and Councilmember Ross is coming to the podium.
Robert, Elizabeth, come on. Good evening. Okay, good. This is a proclamation of the City of Lynnwood recognition of Arts Education Month. Whereas the arts, including dance, music, theater, and visual arts, as well as literary arts, state's definition of basic education and considered an essential component of the complete and balanced education for all students. Whereas learning in and through the arts enables students to develop critical thinking and problem-solving skills, imagination and creativity, discipline, alternate ways to communicate and express feelings and ideas, and cross-cultural understanding, which supports academic success across the curriculum, as well as personal growth outside of the classroom. And whereas imagination and creativity are increasingly understood as critical capabilities needed for success in the 21st century workforce. And whereas the arts can transform our schools into havens of creativity and exploration, places where students want to learn, teachers want to teach, and all members of the learning community are more engaged and motivated. And whereas high-quality school-based arts education involves a wide range of partners, including school boards, district administrators, educators, parents, artists, and art organizations, community members, and local businesses and organizations whose collective endeavors towards equitable provision of arts learning for all students, we celebrate and promote. And whereas we applaud the efforts and dedication of arts education and advocates around the state, and we call for school and community leaders to continue to broaden and strengthen their commitment to provide arts education for every student in every school. Now, therefore, be it resolved that we, the Mayor and City Council of the City of Lynnwood, do hereby proclaim May 2019 as Arts Education Month in Lynnwood, and call on all community members to join us in this special observation. Robert?
I'm Robert Guchek, part of the Arts Commission. And the Arts Commission thanks Mayor Smith and the City Council for recognizing the value of arts education, both in the schools as well as in the entire community. And we invite you, as part of this community in Lynnwood, to celebrate the Explore event that we have on June 13th with a artist reception. Thank you.
Thank you. Photo? Thank you. Moving on to item 70, are there any written communications or petitions? No. It's time for council comments and announcements, and I'd like to start with Councilmember Sessions this evening.
Thank you. My screen went dark for some reason. Hold on just a sec here. Okay. Thank you. I love it when I get to go first. Welcome, everybody. Welcome, everybody in the audience. We love to see you when you're here. I just wanted to add on a little bit to what the mayor said. There's so many good things going on. And just particularly last Wednesday, we had the joint boards and commissions meeting, and we did that last year as well. Actually, might have been the year before. Yeah, third year, and it's so beneficial. It's like one of my favorite meetings of all to get all these stakeholders together and people who obviously really care because they spend their volunteer time being part of the city and really actively working for us voluntarily, and we get so much out of it. So thanks for continuing to do that, and just especially thank you to the staff who take a lot of good care to put that together. And then I want to remind everybody that Memorial Day is this month. It's on Monday, May 27th, and Lynnwood has an annual event at 11 a.m. at our Veterans Park next to the library. Please join us. And also, I'm thankful for Deputy Chief Brian Stanifer, and looking forward. He has an event on the 15th, Wednesday the 15th, a goodbye, a small goodbye, and he's just, he has contributed a lot to not only the police department, but also crossed over to a lot of the different sections of the police or of the city, not to mention, like was mentioned, regionally, and he's actually the person who hired me too for the police department. So I'm happy for him in his next chapter. and just wanted to publicly thank him for his devoted, committed service to our community. Thank you.
Councilmember Cotton, you ready?
I never know, clockwise or counterclockwise, so that's good.
Keep you on your end.
Yeah. I would just echo Deputy Chief Stanifer. I had the honor of serving on the Snow Calm Board with him, which, if you didn't know, we, Snohomish County, we used to have two 911 call centers and dispatch agencies, Snow Calm and Snow Pack. And then in 2017, we merged those two agencies into one, which eliminated a 24-second call transfer time that came to light during the very tragic Michael Teo high school shooting. Wasn't at the high school, but it was involved some high schoolers. That really brought to light that call transfer, and Brian was really instrumental in working behind the scenes to eliminate those call transfers and merging those agencies. So George Hurst and I were part of that, the mayor and several staff members were part of that, but Brian was definitely one of the champions regionally that got that done. So thank you, Brian. You've done good work here. The other thing, I didn't really have anything prepared today, but just in response to some of the comments, I believe, as I was checking back through my notes, one of the issues with the pesticides was we had a miscalibrated spray head on one of our automatic sprayers, but I wonder if it wouldn't be a good idea sometime before our August break to have Director Franz come back and just report on our gallons of pesticide consumed for the city, because I know that we tabulate that, and maybe let us know as a council what the fiscal impact of moving away from a glyphosate type pesticide would be. I know that he mentioned a couple times what the cost would be to maybe burn or use other methods, so maybe it would be a good opportunity to hear from him, because there's an impact, I understand, from a labor standpoint. So that'd be my only ask, and those are my few comments. Thank you.
Thank you. Councilmember Sutton.
Thank you very much. I don't know if any of you have gone out to the Little Leaguers and watched them play ball or anything on that order, but they really are a wonderful group of people. And so I spent a little time at the Lindell Park watching family members and four-legged members enjoying a wonderful, wonderful day. And it really was a wonderful day. And so I just want to encourage all of you to remember that we do have youth in our parks and just to be there to support them. Thank you.
Council President Goodwin.
Thank you. I just want to welcome everyone and thank all of the community members that have come out and continue to come out to inform the City Council, to inform policy, and to help keep us accountable. I appreciate the thoughts and ideas that come to us and that help us as a council to really make sure that we're doing what our jobs are, which really for the most part is policy making and making sure that the policies and those things that we do that really affect all of us in the community are the things that are best for the community. So I appreciate, as I know all the council members do, because whenever we have people that come in and are willing to speak, to share their thoughts and concerns, there's always gratitude from us to you for doing that. So thank you. And the one ask is that you continue to do so and continue to come to us and let us know your concerns and worries and what it is that we're doing wrong, and especially those things that you think we're doing right. Those are helpful as well. So thank you.
Vice President Frizzell.
I would like to echo some words that have already been talked about getting out in our parks. On Saturday, I went out to the Cascade Bike Club gathering, and we had seven members from the city of Lynnwood, and they gave us all kinds of advice and instruction on how to ride the right way and the wrong way, and just lots of general information and some very specific information about our parks and making sure we observe the laws of the road. So I would encourage us to get on our bicycles and get out there. We have a wonderful interurban trail that I rode a couple weeks ago, and it's just beautiful out there. So get out, just get out, and go out there and bike and walk and play and participate. The city has a number of events going on that are organized this summer, and there's always unorganized events as well. So I just encourage all of us to get out. On a much more serious note, President Goodwin and I serve on the South County Fire Regional Authority Commission Board, and we heard this morning of the passing of one of our commissioners. Richard Schrock has been ill for quite some time, and it's with deep sadness that we express condolences to his family. He was a master at legislation, and he was instrumental in getting the CSRS radio system up and going, and working alongside folks. And sometimes it was a rocky road. It wasn't all smooth, but he stuck with it, and our communities are better for it. And we'll pass on future news as far as a memorial when we get that. Thank you.
Thank you. Councilmember Ross.
Yes, several things have already been mentioned this evening. I do want to remind everyone, those of you who are here, you can see the wonderful display in the lobby of all of the eggs from this year's Explore. We will be having a reception in June where you'll actually be able to buy some of the pieces that are out there. They're all incredible. And if you haven't been to City Hall, please make an effort to come and take a look at them, because they are absolutely wonderful. And each one is unique and an actual work of art that you could buy. So, thank you.
And Councilmember Hurst.
Great, thank you. Let me first talk about a week or so ago, the Veterans Museum had its second anniversary, and it was great to see that some of the displays were put out into the center portion. They got to spread out a little more, and it's just apparent that, you know, that museum needs a bigger space. So I hope we can go forward on that someday. This week is the Snow 911 board meeting that I'm part of, and as Councilmember Cotton mentioned, the 911 Snohomish 911 was created through the consolidation of SnowCom and SnowPack, and not only did it result in vastly improved service, but now we're finding that it's actually resulting in cost savings. And so Lynnwood is finding reduced assessments from the 911 service. Then this year, CSRS, the Snohomish Emergency Radio System, merged with Snohomish 911. And again, I was just in a finance meeting last week, and initially it looks like, again, there'll be savings because of this consolidation. And so not only does this improve service, but it's great to show that we have a cost savings. In fact, no, it's not the only agency that's finding savings. The vast majority of all the agencies served, there's like 52 of them, I think, served by 911, and CSRS find savings. I didn't know about Dick Schrock's passing away, and he was an important person in educating me as far as fire commissioner board work, and also he served on the RFA planning committee with the mayor and myself and Councilmember Cotton. And so he's actually also serving, or he was on the Snohomish Emergency Radio Advisory Board that I'm on also, which is the board that's going to advise on how to spend the money that's set aside for the new radio system that's going to happen. So he will be sorely missed. I would also like to express my thanks to D.C. Stanifer, though, for all his work, not only for the consolidation of SnowCom, SnowPack, but he worked on the CSRS consolidation, and again, like it's been noted, he leaves Lynnwood a better place, and I really appreciate him. Thank you.
Thank you. We'll move on to item 90. This is business items and other matters. 90.1 is our unanimous consent agenda, and Councilmember Ross, would you please?
I will.
Do the duties.
Any council member want to remove anything from the consent agenda? No? Seeing none? The following items are on the unanimous consent agenda. Item A, contract Teamsters Local 763. Authorize the mayor to sign the labor agreement between the City of Lynnwood and the Teamsters Local 763. Item B, consultant contract supplement 196 Street Southwest Improvements. Authorize the mayor to enter into and execute a contract supplement with contract land and staff to provide additional property acquisition services in the amount not to exceed $60,000. Sales tax does not apply. And item C, voucher approval. Approve claims and payroll in the amount of $3,722,137.18 and $1,170,539.15, respectively.
Thank you. Our unanimous consent agenda will be approved as read. We're off and running on item 90.2. We have two public hearings this evening. The first one is on city center updates. Let me get to my script. So this is our public hearing with regard to city center updates. It's 90.2A on our agenda. And at this time, the City Council and I will conduct a public hearing on the topic of the city center updates. Thank you for attending and participating this evening. The purpose of public hearings is to allow the public to express their views on matters under consideration by the City Council. Citizen input is one of many ways that we advance Lynnwood's vision for an engaged citizenry and responsive government. Decisions will not be made until after citizens have had the opportunity to share their views. The matter of making amendments to the City Center Design Guidelines and LMC Chapter 21.60, City Center, is legislative in nature and common rules for legislative public hearings apply. Public hearings must be fair and free of conflicts of interest. Before we start the proceedings, and this also applies to myself, does any council member have any conflict of interest regarding this matter? Thank you. So now the public hearing is officially open. The sequence of tonight's public hearing will be as follows. City staff will give an oral report that summarizes the matter at hand. The City Council may ask clarifying questions specifically related to staff's presentation or the written information provided. Members of the audience will be invited to come to the lectern to share information you wish the City Council to consider. I'll first call for speakers from the sign-up sheet that was located outside the chamber's entrance. Next, I will call for speakers who have not signed up. After the public testimony portion of this hearing, I will invite city staff to offer clarifying information responsive to the public comments. Then the City Council may ask clarifying questions of the speakers specifically related to their testimony. Citizens' responses must be made from the lectern. I may allow members of the public to return to the lectern to share new information that was not offered initially. This will only be allowed when circumstances suggest that additional information is needed to fulfill the purpose of the hearing. After each citizen has had the opportunity to speak and the City Council is ready to begin its deliberation, I will close the public hearing. Occasionally, public hearings are reopened or held to a future meeting. And after the hearings close, the City Council can begin its deliberation and ultimately determine what action should be taken. Alternatives available to our council include approve the matter as written, approve the matter as amended by City Council, discontinue further consideration or decline to take action, and finally continue the public hearing or council deliberation to a future meeting. As mayor, my role is to facilitate the hearing and council's deliberation. It's important that public hearings are conducted in a manner that's equitable to all. We'll use the following ground rules for this public hearing. Written minutes and an electronic recording of this meeting are being made. When coming to the lectern, speakers should state their name and address. Please speak into the microphone so that others can hear you. Comments may only be made from the lectern. Only one person may speak at a time. Speakers will be allowed up to 3 minutes to share their views. I may adjust the order of speakers when doing so supports the purpose of this hearing. Everyone is asked to respect opinions that differ from yours and to help ensure members of the audience are not intimidated or discouraged from expressing their views. The purpose of this hearing is to receive citizen input. It's not the time for back-and-forth discussion or for debate. This public hearing is open, and I will now ask Senior Planner Ashley Winchell to provide an overview of the topic at hand.
Good evening. So before you today are updates to us. Oh, and this is Carl Almgren. He's our City Center Program Manager, and he'll be here if there's any specific questions about City Center. He's available for questions and additional input to this presentation. So what's before you today, there was a work session last week, and so this is the public hearing for that work session to go over the changes to the City Center Design Guidelines and the City Center Chapter 2160 of the Zoning Code. So the design guidelines that regulate what buildings look like and how sites are developed, and then the zoning code that has to do with things like permitted uses, building height, setbacks, and things like that. So, moving forward, again, this is the area that's within the City Center. So, essentially, 194th Street to the north, I-5 to the east and south, and 48th Street to the west. So, the entire area in yellow is zoned City Center, and anything zoned City Center is regulated by the Chapter 2160 and the City Center Design Guidelines. So just to quickly go over how this is all regulated again, I know this looks very familiar from last week, but the City Center sub-area plan defines the community vision, and so that's what put together the framework for the section of the zoning code and for the City Center design guidelines. The zoning code, again, it's what regulates the community vision, so it provides the regulatory framework to meet the goals of the City Center sub-area plan. And then the City Center design guidelines promote the character defined within the community vision. So it gets at what the City Center should look like to meet the goals of the City Center. Just to quickly go over how we've got here, we've had two developments completed to date in the City Center, the City Center Apartments and the Shag, or now Destination Senior Living. And so one of the things we did as we came up with what changes we'd like to see to the City Center design guidelines is we reviewed these buildings and tried to find where we hit the mark and where we missed the mark, and if we could change some of our regulations to make sure that we don't miss the mark moving forward. And so what we got into was changes in setbacks, materials, locations of gateways, and things along those lines. So last week you all provided some feedback, and I just wanted to note that feedback and what we've changed, or just identify wanted to point out some of the things that were brought up that are covered in our guidelines. So first, there was a reference to the dark skies ordinance. While our code doesn't specifically reference the dark skies ordinance, it does reference LMC 2117, which is site lighting, and that was written using the model dark skies ordinance. So it's the implementation of that ordinance. So that is covered in there. And then there was discussion about the one-story kiosks associated with a park, and so we added that the one-story kiosk must also be approved by a development agreement. So that way we do have some ability to make sure that that one-story kiosk is continuing the goals of the City Center. So that was something that was added. I'm just going to quickly go over how these are regulated again. Again, there weren't that many changes from last week to this week, so the presentation is essentially the same. The site design standards really regulate how the site itself is designed. It doesn't get into the building, but it gets into the sidewalks, the parking areas, the landscaping, and those things. So like we discussed last week, we added some allowances to have a small drive aisle in front of certain types of residential uses, recognizing with Uber and Amazon and all of the deliveries that are happening, that there are vehicles that could potentially block traffic, and so we wanted to provide some allowances to get those vehicles off the street and make sure that we're keeping traffic moving and that people are able to get the services they need we do understand that City Center is still very car-oriented, and it's going to take a while for us to get to that sweet spot, and so we need to make sure that we're accommodating all modes of transportation. We also have provisions in here that have to do with sidewalk cafes, parking lot screening, different things along those lines, landscaping. We want to make sure that when people are moving through City Center that there's a character throughout, that our auto uses are well screened, and that we are making sure when we start adding things like sidewalk cafes and things like that, that we aren't creating issues for handicap access or for people walking in large groups through the sidewalk. We want to make sure that pedestrian traffic is flowing, and so we've made minor changes that we think will improve that. And then we've also looked at our gateway standards, and we are trying to focus on our higher quality gateway features versus some of the, I wouldn't say lower quality, but easier to meet. So right now it's a toolbox, and so what we want to change it to is really focusing on getting at our gateways art or water features or monuments versus landscaping and lighting, which is already required. We wanted to make sure that there was one piece that really defined our gateway intersections, and so we're focusing on that versus having kind of a toolbox of some lower end treatments. We want to make sure that those gateways are really focused on. So that's a quick summary of what the design standards do, and all of the changes that we have made are really focusing on strengthening those design standards. As I mentioned last week, we also added allowances for certain types of fencing and things like that. When the City Center design guidelines were written, there weren't necessarily as many allowances for when you're abutting residential, what kind of screening you can have, or dog parks, you know, what kind of fencing can you have for a dog park. Play areas and things like that. The bulk of our changes are in the building design standards. One of our biggest focuses was on materials, and our current design standards essentially just say high quality materials, but it's super subjective, and we wanted to really get into what materials we wanted to see on what part of the building. And so we went to Bothell, we went to Redmond, we looked at national examples, we went to as many neighborhoods as we could to see how materials were being used and how we think materials should be used in Lynnwood. And so we wanted to make sure, one, that peer cities are getting the materials that we want to see, and then two, what materials do we think would have the biggest impact on the overall character. And so focusing on masonry on the ground level, so things like brick and stone and certain types of concrete treatments, and then also making sure that hardy panel is a very popular material, and we want to make sure that we're not getting just a lot of hardy panel, and so giving some allowances to make sure that we're getting a mix of materials so we don't end up with just hardy panel buildings all over City Center. And in case anyone doesn't know, hardy panel is the flat kind of 8x4 sheets. There's a lot of it on the City Center apartments. It can be done really well, and it can also be done in a way that's really flat. And so we just want to make sure that we're focusing on getting it done right instead of getting it done easy. Some of our other changes, just strengthening some of our transparency requirements, and then again adding allowances for uses that are private in nature. So things like doctor's offices, daycares, gyms, things like that. Strengthening some of our entry requirements, making sure that there's at least one focal entry on every building, and then some requirements for smaller entries. One thing we talked about last week was really strengthening the base, middle, and top. It's a common theme in architecture that good architecture has a base, middle, and top, and so we've provided a toolbox for designers to use as they design buildings to make sure that they are following those basic principles, and with the hope that we do get high-quality architecture. The toolboxes are fairly flexible and large, so that way architects have that ability to design in their vision, and developers can use that as well, but really focusing on making sure that we are keeping those standards. And then, the Convention Center is on here because it's a really good example of the kind of architecture and buildings we'd like to see continued in City Center. We also added some provisions for our parking garages just to make sure that parking garages are well screened and well designed in City Center. Finally, we made some changes to the actual zoning code. Those changes focus on making sure that we're getting as much building at the street line as or at the right-of-way line as possible. And so we added some allowances or some requirements for frontage based on the size of the lot. And then there are some kind of landlocked parcels in City Center. And so we made sure that those landlocked parcels, they can't provide frontage because they don't have frontage. And so we made sure that we recognized those sorts of buildings. We also had some provisions that were overly restrictive. We had a requirement that the whole ground floor of the building be occupiable space, which meant that there couldn't be any back of house features or parking or anything like that on the ground level. And so we just wanted to provide a percentage that had to be active because it's hard to anticipate what a building may need based on the site or based on the uses inside. And so we went to a 60% active use on the ground floor, which would give 40% for storage, parking, those sorts of things. It would also have to be designed and screened in a way that meets the guidelines, but it gives a little bit more flexibility to make sure that it's not so restrictive that it's causing them to need a variance or some sort of waiver to the requirements. And then finally, the document which is attached to the ordinance is, we made sure to pull in a lot of pictures and make it very easy to use and very graphic. That would conclude my presentation of the changes before you all today. If there's any questions or anything, I'm here to answer those.
Thank you, Ashley. Does any member of City Council have a question to clarify information provided by Ashley's presentation or in the written materials that you have? Councilmember Ross?
Ashley, you might not be able to answer this off the top of your head, but have you gotten any feedback that this is going to cause more expensive development and people are going to be less likely to do it, or is this just part of operating a development business?
We have shared this with two different development groups and neither have specifically voiced that concern. We did sit down with one of those and kind of talk about what we're doing and make changes based on their feedback, because we definitely don't want to stop development. We do, though, understand that sometimes higher quality development might have a higher cost, and so we're trying to balance making sure we're not making it too expensive, mm-hmm. but also making sure that we're getting buildings that will last and are attractive and make City Center somewhere people want to be.
Excellent. Thank you.
Councilmember Hurst?
Great. Thank you. I asked this last Monday, but I just want to make sure, because a lot of these changes are more technical, architectural changes that, I haven't studied entirely. As we know, I'm a history major. What do I know? I just want to make clear that, none of these changes are specific to a developer's request.
No.
Okay.
No, these are all, I'd call some of them lessons learned, and some of them are things that, as we started going through the code and we're getting more development pressures, realizing that we may need to create some flexibility or anticipate that we want to make sure that we're holding all the developers to a higher standard.
Okay. Then the other question I have, and the slide's not up here, but it's in our packet, and it goes to the streets that are involved in the City Center.
Mm-hmm.
And I just think that I want to be aware that I think 194th is really problematic as far as being part of the City Center, because I think the cost of right-of-way, punching it all the way through 30th to 36th, and also if we do that, we are dividing the public facility district that the convention center sits on, and that's also a problem. So I just kind of would like folks to be aware that at least I'm concerned about it. Thank
okay.
you.
Thank you.
Other council questions? All right. Moving on, are there any written materials or correspondence that has not yet been distributed to council? Now I'll invite members of the audience to come forward to speak, starting with those who signed up. And nobody signed up. So is there anyone in the audience who would like to speak this evening? Annie?
Annie Lyman, 1950 140th Avenue. And I'm sorry I missed the workshop. It sounds like there was a lot of valuable information given. But I didn't hear anything tonight about safety, personal safety. And I am quite concerned about 40th on the fire trucks and the police access to my particular residence, because there is no safe place for the fire trucks to park and still allow that one lane of uphill traffic to come by. And so I missed the discussion. I'm sorry about that. But if there's some clarification about that, I think that's a really important issue. Thank you.
Thank you. Steve Greenbaum? Stephen Greenbaum.
Stephen Greenbaum. And my, these are just questions because, as you said, I wasn't here in all of this. The only reason I'm here now is because I spoke earlier. And just a quick couple of questions. And if the questions aren't relevant, I'm happy. But if they are relevant, I'd ask you to consider them. I didn't hear, and of course these are all updates, so I'm hoping that you have taken into account ecological viability. And if you haven't, that this needs to be addressed. One of the things, as you may remember, is a few years ago, we all got together and agreed that Lynnwood would abide by the Paris Climate Accords. And I want to make sure and hope that we are doing that in this development. And that always remembering, this is something that's on my mind because this is what I talked about in my sermon last Saturday, posterity awareness. We're not just building for now. We're building for our kids and grandkids. And if there are ecological problems that are coming either because there's so much, you know, so much, as I look at it, impermeable surface. Is this, have we taken, and again, I'm asking, I don't know, have we taken into account how we deal with water, how we deal with making sure that there are trees and things are working so that environmentally, so that not only is it working now for the city of Lynnwood and providing good space now, but that, and I feel honored, I'm older than Lynnwood. and thank you for making this month all about me. I remember I was Old Folks Month. But if you can please just be sure that you are being environmentally responsible and taking into ecological, and if you are, terrific. And if you aren't, I'd ask you to consider that before taking any votes that nail this down. Thank you.
Thank you. Ted Heichel?
Ted Heichel, 3820, 191st Place Southwest in Lynnwood. And I would salute Mr. Greenbaum, and I would join him since I turn 81 on Wednesday. I really appreciated in the document that was online, the quote, "These changes respond to lessons learned from previous development." That's something government needs to proclaim to the citizens. And hopefully something like a 0.9 parking space for every apartment in a senior apartment building was inadequate and was so stated by staff earlier this year. There were a few lines that bugged me. Quote, "The community development director may approve, the community development director may grant deviations, the director may deviate from this standard, the community development director is authorized to determine." These are all things that are not nailed down in your document, and in my opinion, they should be. Otherwise, you are giving power to one staff member to make major changes in what should be the city council's decision, and I think you need to do that. One comment I would have about what was online, the pictures that were in the document, and the document, if I recall, was something like 50 pages long. Most of the pictures online seem to be multifamily buildings. And I'm deeply concerned that we're going down that road again, that with a light rail station, you're going to have massive multifamily housing. And you're forgetting what we did when we put in, what we said when we put in the original city center zoning back, what was it, 2005? And we said, we want buildings, office buildings, with higher paying jobs, with white collar jobs, so that we change the mix of our employees in the city from minimum wage jobs in retail to something that could sustain a person who is going to live in the city. $15 an hour, even if we got that high, you're talking about $30,000 a year, and nobody can buy a house in Lynnwood making $30,000 a year. That should be part of what you're doing when you make these upgrades in what you're asking the buildings to look like, but what they function for, and that is better paying jobs in our community.
Thank you. Yes, ma'am.
Mayor, City Council, my name is Maria Abercrombie, and my residence is 19501 40th Avenue West. I live right here at the Destinations building. A couple of months ago in February, we had an incident at our building where four floors had to be evacuated in the southeast corner. Apartments had to be evacuated. The fire department came out because carbon monoxide gas was coming into our apartments. And this was part of the design of the building in which, for concern for the aesthetics on the outside, blocked somehow, impaired the proper venting of the combustion of a boiler that was down in the garage. So I would ask that in consideration of the design of the building that be, you know, that's a safety for the residents in any building. They had to remove that nice beautiful plate, which I'm sure was very costly. And now what sticks out on the side of the building are these huge white PVC pipes, which are, you know, for our safety. I'm thankful for that, but I'm sure that was not part of the original design. So that needs to really be taken into consideration, is that the outside also take into consideration safety and the proper venting. Thank you. Yes. Abercrombie, Abercrombie. Thank you.
Are there others who'd wish to speak tonight? All right, staff, would you wish to offer clarifying information in response to the citizen testimony?
Yeah, Carl and I will share some of those responses. So the first one to 40th and the fire truck access. So we have several different documents that regulate what happens in City Center, and so we have our streetscape plans, which regulate the width of the streets and the sidewalks and the plantings, and so these documents really regulate private development. I know that there are some, we might be looking at documents moving forward and making sure that we're operating from the same set of maps, and so there might be some consideration in the future of what changes with street widths and things like that, but tonight this wouldn't cover anything on public right-of-way. It would only cover private development. For ecological viability, that's something that we've been talking about for citywide and green building standards and things like that. It's something that we really want to make sure when we do it, we get it right. There's a lot of complexity to some of those, but I'll let Carl talk a little bit about what we do have in place.
So one of the things we have in place is the multifamily tax exemption, which allows builders to receive a property tax reduction over a certain period of time, provided that one of the things that they do is enter into a development agreement with the city, as well as they design their building to be designed to LEED Silver status. That doesn't necessarily have to be certified, but has to be designed to those levels. So that's one way that we're incorporating green building designs into private development through incentivization and meeting those needs. One of the things about these design standards is it doesn't necessarily prohibit those uses, and it does provide some discretion to be able to utilize different opportunities in the future through the community development director's discretion through those proposed projects.
Yeah, and then just for stormwater or anything like that, every project's reviewed under whatever the current stormwater standards are to make sure that they're retaining on site and not overloading any of our systems. Of course, there are requirements for landscaping and street trees and things along those lines to make sure that we are getting greenery in City Center. And a lot of our focus on higher quality materials is because we do want these buildings to last, and we want them to stay for a while, and we want people to love City Center and love the buildings in City Center. And so that was one of our big focuses on materials, is to make sure that we're building construction that will last and has a visual lasting quality. I know there's been a lot of discussion about parking, and it's another thing we've talked about in our office, and so we acknowledge that there is a need to look at changes to parking, but we want to again make sure that we get parking right in Lynnwood and make sure that we get parking right in City Center. And parking is a super complex, you know, getting the ratios right and not throwing developments off because of that. And so that's something we'll probably be looking at in the future, but not necessarily with these changes. It's also something that we're aware of what that parking requirement did with in that area, and so working with developers to make sure that they're providing enough parking. Let's see, the city development director deviations is very standard in all of our design guidelines, and so we don't necessarily grant those, you know, often, but there have been opportunities where maybe there's some sort of utility underneath a planting area, and so the number of street trees they can provide, they need to provide 6 and they can only provide 4 because the trees may interfere with the utilities that are underground. Those are some of the sorts of things that we've deviated in the past, or you know, these design guidelines may not encompass everything that could happen, and someone might bring us something that's really good that we can deviate from these standards. So the city development director, I would say how it's worked in the past is while the director grants the deviation, it's more of a collaborative approach where we talk about it as a staff to make sure that we're all in agreement that we're still getting something good. So there are some standards in the project design review chapter to determine if that deviation is warranted.
Some of the comments discussed the use of the multifamily images and the extent of them. That's our responsiveness to some of the lessons learned, as well as the responsiveness to the region where we're seeing a specific type of construction pattern occurring around light rail stations. So the concerns with using those images is to provide better guidance to development coming in. The city center does look for office opportunities as well as mixed use, and the planned action ordinance that the city council adopted identifies certain levels of where we expect to see commercial uses as well as a total number of units. So we are looking for that balance as we're moving forward, but again, those images are really to help highlight what Lynnwood is looking for in the city center related to these design standards.
And then having to do with the interior and exterior of the building, you know, I don't know if that's an oversight in a building review or something got built differently than what was in but that's something we're very aware of, and that's something too where deviations can come into play, where there maybe needs to be a pipe coming out in a certain area, and we can work with them on screening and those sorts of things. So, you know, it's something that we're very aware of making sure that we're reviewing buildings and keeping our residents safe. And so it's unfortunate that something happened, but I'm glad that, you know, we're aware of it, and hopefully moving forward we can make sure that we're catching anything like that or whatnot.
Right. Okay, Council, do you have any questions to clarify information provided by the public or the staff? So at this time, since all citizens wishing to speak have had an opportunity to do so, and since the City Council has had the opportunity to ask questions regarding the testimony provided, it's appropriate to close the public comment portion of this hearing. Unless the council wishes to take action to keep the hearing open or to continue the hearing to a future meeting, the hearing should be considered closed. And audience, thank you so much for being here. So at this time, I invite council to make a motion to begin discussion and deliberation. Council President.
Can I have an ordinance number, please?
3336.
I move that we, the City Council of the City of Lynnwood, Washington, adopt Ordinance Number 3336, an ordinance of the City of Lynnwood, Washington, relating to regulations for the City Center zoning districts, amending LMC 21.60.100, 21.60.300, and 21.60.400, adding a new LMC 21.60.350. repealing existing City Center design guidelines as adopted by Ordinance Number 2937, adopting updated City Center design guidelines, and providing for severability and effective date and summary publication.
Second.
Thank you, Council President. Would you like to speak to the ordinance?
I would, yes. The process that we've gone through, that the staff has gone through, to make the changes that they have, not only to the documents themselves, but the research that they've done, the lessons learned, all of this is to make and help the designs to be better for the city. And I think a lot of that consideration that has taken place has to do with future growth, with, you know, as was mentioned, when in the documents it's mentioned the lesson learned, that shows this, you know, this is where we're at. This is where we're trying to go. Specifically, I think it's important to note that we can't possibly put zoning regulations for every single thing that can occur. And as Ashley mentioned, doing so, I think, would actually hurt more than it would help these documents and the building designs. So I think it is also appropriate to give some leeway to the director or to whomever in that position can make those decisions, because as was mentioned, when we have, you know, when you have a building that's or a plan that says there's supposed to be six trees and there's something that's in the way that has to do with electrical or the water, and putting a tree over that would at some point prohibit the water or the electricity from actually flowing into the building, the City Council, I think, is not in as good a position to determine that as a professional like the director of that department. So I think it's very appropriate to have the director be have some leeway and be able to make those decisions, because all of those decisions don't need to come to the council for approval, and I think it's very appropriate to do that. So I appreciate the work that you've done, and really especially holding yourselves accountable for things that you've seen in the past or that we may have done that could probably be done better, and so stating here's a lesson learned and here's how we're going to improve that. So I appreciate that as well. Thank you.
Councilmember Cotton.
Thank you, Honor. I'll echo some of what Council President said, just commending staff for their hard work on this. I know that this is, you know, just reading through the document, it's a very lengthy and robust and detailed document. So I appreciate that, and I appreciate you also helping guide us in the understanding that
this lays on top of all of the other current existing codes that we have for building and built environments within the zoning. So I appreciate all of that. I'm also of the like mind that I think that having some flexibility allows us to also react to new technologies. You know, I don't know whether we'll see any development with structured timber in Lynnwood, but it's certainly exciting to hear about those kinds of developments, because structured timber, if you haven't heard about it, is actually a carbon negative because it entraps carbon, because it's timber as opposed to concrete or steel, which are carbon positive. So I think allowing some kind of leeway and some kind of leaving that and trusting the department director to make the right call for the community is appropriate. I also appreciate the comments about that we're promoting LEED and those kinds of things, which are adopted in accredited agencies that are actually provide metrics and abilities for us to say this building is more environmentally friendly than that building, because without any kind of standard or measuring stick, we really kind of don't know. So I'm in support of this. I think staff has done a very good job of briefing us and doing their homework. I will also note that on some of the standards here, we do talk about pedestrian crossings and promenades and some of the very specific street development stuff. So there is some language in there too that addresses making sure that there's appropriate pedestrian crossings marked upgraded, so to speak. So I'm in support of that, and great work from staff. Thank you.
Any other council comments? Council Vice President Frizzell.
I also wanted to just express my appreciation for the hard work that's gone into the updates here and the considerations, and also for the wonderful input that we had from our citizens that have just brought things to light, and we'll be taking them into account as we move forward, and I just appreciate the involvement by the citizens. Thank you.
Other council comments? Yeah, okay. Call for the vote, please. Mm-hmm.
Councilmember Cotton.
Aye.
Council Vice President Frizzell.
Yes.
Council President Goodwin.
Affirmative.
Councilmember Hurst.
Yes.
Councilmember Ross.
Yes.
Councilmember Sessions.
Yes.
Councilmember Sutton.
Yes.
7 yes, Mayor.
Thank you. Ordinance number 3336 passes unanimously. Thank you. All right, we'll move on to our second public hearing this evening. This is a public hearing. It's an ordinance approving a development agreement for the Lynnwood Place Phase 2 project. So at this time, the City Council and I will conduct a public hearing to adopt an ordinance approving the Lynnwood Place Phase 2 development agreement between the City of Lynnwood, Edmonds School District Number 15, Wakefield Alderwood LLC, and Alderwood Commercial LLC, and the Home Depot Corporation. The purpose of public hearings is to allow the public to express their views on matters under consideration by the City Council. Decisions will not be made until after citizens have had the opportunity to comment on this application. The matter of a development agreement is a quasi-judicial in nature, and common rules for such hearings apply. For quasi-judicial matters, the City Council will base its decision upon the evidence and testimony made part of the record during the hearing on the matter. Public hearings must be fair and free of conflicts of interest. So before we start the proceedings, and this also applies to myself, it's important that we disclose potential conflicts of interest and communications outside of this hearing. Accordingly, I ask each of us at the dais to follow the following questions. Does anyone have a financial or personal interest in this property or issue? Does anyone stand to gain or lose financially from the council's decision? Does anyone have any reason to believe that they cannot hear and consider this matter in a fair and objective manner? All right. Has anyone received information or engaged in communication outside of this hearing with proponents or opponents of the issue at hand? And no one answered these in the affirmative. Attorney Larson, I think we're good to go. All right. Does the audience object to my participation or any council member's participation in these proceedings? And if so, that person should come forward to the lectern now and state the objection. Well, now, the public hearing is officially open. An official recording is being made of what is said during this hearing, so it's essential that anyone addressing the City Council do so from the lectern. The written materials provided in the agenda packet will be considered part of the official record for this matter. The sequence of tonight's public hearing will be as follows. Everyone wishing to speak during this hearing will be asked to swear under oath that their testimony will be truthful. Our city staff will provide an oral report that summarizes the matter at hand. The City Council may ask clarifying questions specifically related to staff's report. Members of the audience will be invited to come to the lectern to share information you wish the City Council to consider. First, I will call for speakers from the sign-up sheet that was located outside the chamber's entrance. After that, I will call for speakers who did not sign up. After the public testimony portion of this hearing, I will invite city staff to offer clarifying information responsive to the public comments. The City Council may ask clarifying questions of the speakers, specifically related to their testimony. Citizen responses must be made from the lectern. Once everyone has had an opportunity to speak, I will ask each speaker if they wish to speak a second time, for the sole purpose of rebutting or correcting the testimony or evidence provided by another speaker. After receiving testimony from interested party and the City Council is ready to begin its deliberation, I will close the public hearing. Occasionally, public hearings are reopened or held to a future meeting. After the hearing's closed, the City Council can begin its deliberation and ultimately determine what actions should be taken. Alternatives available to City Council include approve the matter as written, approve the matter as amended or conditioned by the City Council, deny the matter, continue the public hearing or council deliberation to a future meeting. As mayor, my role is to facilitate the hearing and council's deliberation, and we will use the following ground rules for this public hearing. When coming to the lectern, speakers should state their name and address. Please speak into the microphone so that others can hear you and so that your testimony can be recorded. Comments may only be made from the lectern. Only one person may speak at a time, and please be concise in your testimony. I may adjust the orders of speakers when doing so supports the purpose of this hearing. Everyone is asked to respect opinions that differ from yours and to help ensure members of the audience are not intimidated or discouraged from expressing their views. The purpose of this hearing is to receive citizen input. It is not the time for back and forth discussion or for debate. I will now ask David Kleitch, Economic Development Director and our Interim Community Development Director, to provide an overview of the topic at hand.
Thank you, Mayor, members of council. Sorry for the sudden onset of a cough. At the work session on May 6th, 2019, City Council received a briefing regarding this matter. At that briefing, the draft ordinance, draft development agreement, and background materials were presented for the council. Council was offered the opportunity to ask questions on those matters. Tonight, the staff will, for the record, provide an overview for council of the materials and also a brief presentation of the proposed project. As the mayor mentioned, this is a quasi-judicial matter. Ultimately, City Council is being asked to adopt an ordinance approving a development agreement for the southern portion of the former Lynnwood High School property. The property is located on 184th Street, directly north of Alderwood Mall. The development is proposed as a mixed-use project with housing, commercial buildings, a Home Depot, landscaping, and parking. The proposal is in compliance with the zoning for this area, and the Home Depot has received a conditional use permit previously, which is needed for them to move forward. The project components have also completed the project design review process. So what you see tonight will be what's in the document that was reviewed administratively, and we'll move forward upon approval of the development agreement. Infrastructure improvements are the provision of a trail connection between Alderwood Mall Parkway and the Inner Urban Trail. This connection will provide direct access from the Alderwood, across Alderwood Parkway from Lynnwood Place to the Inner Urban Trail. Street improvements that may be provided if necessary are improvements at Maple Road, which is east of Alderwood Mall Parkway, a small turn lane, through lane, roughly in the vicinity of the AMPM Mini Mart, as well as a construction, thank you, David, of a traffic signal and full intersection improvements at 184th Street. What is asked of council in the development agreement is that if acquisition of right-of-way is needed for those two components, that be the responsibility of the city. The city has looked at that situation, sees that as a matter that can easily be accommodated, but further analysis is reviewed pending design of those two improvement projects. The two components of the project, the mixed use and the Home Depot, are also responsible for the payment of city impact fees and service charges pursuant to the LMC. I'd also like to draw your attention to the council packet regarding the questions from the work session. So the work session questions have been outlined, summarized and outlined for the council. And I want to mention specifically question four. Question four has been clarified that the work session, it was stated that the reduction for parking was 63 spaces, which was 7% of the total. So I'll repeat that. A reduction of 63 spaces, which was 7% of the total for the mixed-use project. We're coming off a earlier version of that calculus. It is a reduction of 146 spaces, or 15% of the total, primarily in anticipation or providing flexibility to the developer for the provision of a restaurant, if one.
Director Kleitch, could you please tell us what page you're on? These questions are being answered?
I'm on page B67.
B6.
I'm on line 21 of page B67. And it is the last exhibit in your packet, all the way at the end. So it's after exhibit F of the development agreement.
90.2B-67, it's the last attachment in your packet. We're getting caught up with you. All right? Okay, thank you.
My apologies. So there I would like to point out line 26, that paragraph clarifies the reduction. I would also like to point out that the Home Depot did not request a parking reduction. And finally, I would also like to draw Council's attention to page B68, question 7. That would be on line 6 of page B68. That just outlines the parking that will be provided by the project, both for the Home Depot and also for the mixed-use component of the project. So with that, I summarized and went through the pages of the document at the work session, received questions from council on that document. So I'll let that document stand in the record as the development agreement, and will answer any specific questions council may have pursuant to the quasi-judicial nature of the proceeding. And I will turn it over to Todd Hall, who will go over the design elements of the project.
All right, thank you, David. Good evening, Council, Mayor. This is just a brief orientation again for the overall project, which includes both Home Depot and the mixed-use component. So I'll keep this brief. We do have the applicants here tonight that will be presenting their own presentations, but I will just go over this in brief for the benefit of the public. So again, Lynnwood Place, just to orient everybody, this is the former Lynnwood High School campus site. So just to the north of Alderwood Mall and to the west of the Target area and to the east of the H-Mart. This area is approximately 40 acres total. And in 2012-2013, there were several actions that took place for the initiation of the overall Lynnwood Place process. This was an interlocal agreement with the Edmonds School District, a comprehensive plan map and text changes, zoning map and text changes, and then Ordinance 3030, which was the development agreement for the Phase 1, which was the Costco development, and then Ordinance 3051, which is the first development agreement for Phase 2. And as David pointed out earlier, this will be superseded by tonight's development agreement. So here's just a overview of the entire Phase 2 site. So on the east side of the site is the Home Depot. That will include some surface parking out on the front and also some rooftop parking. And then the Lynnwood Phase 2 mixed-use buildings that's built on top of a podium, and then we'll have some structured parking underneath the building there. So these are just a couple of snapshots of the Home Depot. The applicant will have some additional photos during their presentation. It's about 347,000 square feet with rooftop parking and a total of 441 spaces. As David mentioned, the design review has been completed. Upon execution of the development agreement, those will be the project design review will be signed by the community development director, and that would be David Kleitch. And then conditional use permit specifically was approved for this particular part of the project, was to allow for the home improvement center and the commercial residential zone. The CR zone is the only zone within the entire city, and as part of the approval process for the Home Depot or Home Improvement Center, a CUP was required, and that went through our hearing examiner. This is just an aerial view of kind of showing how this site layout will work. So you'll see the 184th on the far right side, and then this new bisecting road that will go from north to south through the site, separating both Home Depot and Lynnwood Phase 2. There's a opportunity for a future retail or restaurant out in front of Home Depot there, which is that represented by the white box on the left side. And then you have the surface parking and the rooftop parking above on Home Depot. So moving on to the Lynnwood Place Phase 2 mixed-use building. This is going to be a five-story multifamily residential buildings over a single podium of parking and ground floor retail and surface parking. There will be a total of 500 units, approximately 10,000 square feet of office space, 12,000 square feet of retail, and a total of 876 parking spaces. And like the Home Depot project, this PDR has been completed by staff and will be executed upon the approval of the DA. And then administrative parking reduction was actually completed for this one, as David mentioned earlier, in terms of the question that we just answered, question four in the exhibit. There was a reduction of 15% for that particular project. So this is the site plan for that mixed-use building. So again, on the right side actually is just showing part of that Home Depot parking area, and then on the left side is this project. So you'll have some retail office space on the far east side of the building fronting the bisecting road, and then you have the structured parking underneath the building and under the podium. And then one of the questions was there landscaping provided and reviewed? this is just one sheet of many. I didn't want to include every sheet, but this just gives you a representation of what was submitted to the staff for their review. So it shows extensive landscaping on all sides of the building. There's many more that shows greater detail on the courtyards or the inner courtyards of the building, on the exterior of the building, but just wanted to show the representation of the landscaping plans that were submitted for staff review. These are the elevations that are submitted. So on the top there is the north side. This is the side facing Costco on the inner road. Would be, I believe, 182nd, excuse me. And then the east side is on the bottom there. That's the side facing towards Home Depot. So you'll see on the bottom there some of that retail and office space that would face that inner bisecting road. On the, then the next page here, the top elevation is showing the south. This is the one that's facing 184th. And then the west side, this is the side facing the new ring road that was developed as part of the Lynnwood Place Phase 1 or the Costco project. And then that just bottom corner there is just showing some of the examples of that west elevation, which is the one right above or tucked in the middle there of where that Lynnwood Place signage would be on that wall. So this is one of the perspectives. This is the 182nd and 33rd Avenue. This would be the northwest side. So this is your 33rd or a loop road is the one on the right, and that Costco road. This one is signalized currently going into and out of Costco. So as you're looking at this site, this is where the ponds or the open space currently looks as if you're looking towards the mall. And then this is the 184th and 33rd Avenue side. This one is facing to the northeast. So 184th is the street that's on the bottom there, and then the signalized 33rd loop, which would be kind of rounding around that corner to the left. So just to go over the approval process again, it is a quasi-judicial hearing tonight. And the adoption of the development agreement ordinance will repeal that original ordinance that was approved as part of the original Phase 2 development from a few years back. So that concludes staff's presentation at this time. Thank you very much.
So does any member of City Council have a question to clarify information provided during the staff presentation or in the written materials in your packet? Councilmember Sessions?
Thank you. And thank you for the format of the questions and the answers of the questions. That's helpful. Although I don't really like the answers. So one of my questions was about the rooftop of the parking. So it's just simply that it's not designed to function as a local area for community events. Does that mean that we can't ever use that, that that's not a spot? Can you clarify that, or is that just like some official response?
Well, I would actually leave that up to the Home Depot Corporation. I will say from a building code, public safety, access, it's very restricted and limited. And then I would also say that if you put people up there, you're creating a concentrated, I don't want to say dead load, but a concentrated load on the roof. So that's where you get into the engineering of cars versus people versus massing versus other activities. So between the limited access and the building code issues, which I'm sure Home Depot can talk to later, it's not really seen as feasible for those types of events, and that's why you have the answer you have.
Are we going to be able to hear from the developers tonight? Is that part of?
That's part of the process.
Oh, good. Okay. Well, you know, just trying to think. I mean, I don't really love the roof idea, but it's something creative because I don't see anything else creative about this property, and I'm sad about that because I was hoping that we could do something more creative with it. A reason to cross the street from the mall. And I was hoping that there would be some other ideas. And maybe there will be. Maybe you're still going to talk to me here. But it says, where in the project are the amusement, recreation uses, and retail shops located? There's not. It's not included in the scope, other than the separate retail and restaurants. It's just disappointing. It's such a... That property could be so robust and vibrant, and it's across from a fun area that's only going to be more exciting, and I'm sad that it's not going to be cooler. Then the last question, 15, what are the future plans to reduce congestion on 33rd? So it says here, and I don't remember this at all, but I probably just missed it, that 33rd will be widened to 5 lanes, and then the connection at 33rd and 179th, is that's going to be the new signal in the future? Are they going to take away that other one that's the complicated one, or?
David Bach, Public Works Department.
Thank you.
So when the city worked with the school district originally for phase one, we did work to have dedication to at some point in the future that if the city needs to widen the ring road, what we call the ring road, which is the 33rd road that runs around the perimeter of the site, it's currently 3 lanes wide, that it can be widened to 5 lanes at some point in the future. Okay. Essentially widens toward the west and toward the north. So there is actually the big retaining wall that's along the side of the road there is actually designed in a way that the road could be widened if that's needed at some point. And then regarding your question, and I'm just trying to get caught up to you, on the north end, is that specifically where you're talking about, where the two traffic signals are north of Costco on the ring road?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So I believe that's 30th Place that comes down the hill in close proximity to Alderman Mall Parkway. Mm-hmm. They're only about 100, 200 feet apart mm-hmm. from each other. We do at some point hope to work with, there's a large undeveloped, or there's a single family property adjacent to there that when that, mm-hmm. or if that property redevelops, the city would like to eliminate that 30th Place connection and that signal, and then basically construct a new signal further to the west that would line up with the driveway that enters Costco. So if you're coming in from the north along the 33rd Ring Road, it's the first left you take into the Costco.
I understand. Thank you. Thank you.
Councilmember Ross?
Just curious. I don't know if it's covered in here or if it's covered in the CUP that they had to get, but are there restrictions on taking up parking spaces for things like building materials and lawn mulch around the Home Depot?
I believe that activity occurs in the garden area, and there is an area in the back that is loading and unloading. So there are other areas besides from the front where that would happen. But I would defer to Home Depot in their discussion on where that would specifically be located.
Councilmember Hurst.
Oh, thank you. Back to the section on council questions, one of my questions was not listed, and that is when I asked whether this property was going to have any affordable housing on it or if it's market rate. And I believe Mr. Hall could give us that answer.
Is our understanding from the developer that there's no affordable housing going to be provided on the site?
Okay. And then I had a question on Exhibit D, the lead worksheet, where we get the score. And Home Depot, looks like it, they're certified. So is there any tax incentive for a certified lead building in the city?
The city No, there are not. The only place that that happens, as was mentioned by Mr. Elgrim, was when people locate in housing in the city center, so there isn't a break in this location.
Okay, thank you.
Any other questions, Council? Are there any new written materials or correspondence that has not yet been distributed?
Mayor and Council,
yes.
That would be no.
No.
Thank you. Have not received any.
Thank you. So now I'll invite members of the audience to come forward and speak, and I want to start with the project applicant, the proponent. So if you would like to come forward, you can either speak from the lectern or join the table panel. Sure.
Steve Lawson, I'm with Wakefield Properties LLC, which is actually the developer of this property. We're also dividing into two entities. It'll be Alderwood Commercial LLC and Wakefield Alderwood LLC. It's the same ownership as my partner and I, Len Evans. So, but for breaking the property into two different lots, we have two different entities. Our address is 1457 130th Avenue Northeast in Bellevue, 98005. I guess I'm just going to try to summarize 14 months of hard work into 5 minutes, so I'm probably going to leave a couple details out. We were approached almost 14 months ago by the Edmond School District. My partner and I have been fortunate. We developed the Mill Creek Town Center project. We've developed Snohomish Station. We're just finishing up in Marysville, the marketplace at Smoky Point, and the Lodge, which is a 200,000 square foot commercial center and 542 apartments, which is been a good lead into what we're doing here as far as the number of units and all that. We also recently finished Covington Crossing on Highway 18 in Covington. So just to kind of bring a lot of hard work, research, and stuff to kind of answer some of the questions. I was very aware of this development when Cypress was involved. A number of us developers heard about it. When Costco was involved, but we also knew that they were doing something we were doing at Mill Creek Town Center at the time. And what Mill Creek Town Center was for us was the opportunity with Central Market and University Bookstore we developed on both sides of the street. It was in a time and place when we had a lot of activity with small shops, Blockbusters of the world and all that. And so when we started with this development, when we first got involved with it, my idea was what we had to, it was made pretty clear that the apartments were important to the city. So we developed a number of apartments. We did the Hawthorne in Mill Creek. We did the Kennedy Building at the U District. So we're very familiar with, we're a good developer for this property to do mixed use. As we laid out the apartments, it became clear that we were going to be left with about half the property for commercial. And as we went to ICSC, as we scoured the market and tried to figure out, what our tenant mix would be, we were looking for small shops, coffee shops, small restaurants, and all that. Well, this company called Amazon came along, and it kind of obliterated a lot of the tenants that we were talking to, and we had tenants in our own centers that were, especially small shop tenants, were having a really hard time with this. So it really became down to really the survival of the fittest in the retail market. And when you do the structure that the school district wants, which I think is a very fortuitous and wise move, which is to do it on a 99-year ground lease versus selling the property. Well, you got to think about a developer like us. We got to sleep at night, and you got to, who are you going to put there that you know is going to be around? Is it going to be Toys R Us? Well, probably not. The list goes on. So what we were approached with was the opportunity to get with Home Depot there. And I kind of reacted like you did, Councilmember Sessions, as this wasn't our original idea. But as you look at the marketplace and you look at the opportunity,
I think Home Depot maybe is doing 5 stores this year across the country. They used to do many more stores. We did run up a summer station with them, and they're a very, very fine corporation. So it just we came to the point where it really was what, from a financial standpoint, with the city, us as developers, the school district, what was going to be the long-term ability for the tenants to be there 20 years from now or 30 years from now. And so as we started designing the main, they've done something that it's been very rare across the country is to put rooftop parking on it. So they understood where they were at. They understood the setting that we had. They designed this building because my apartment tenants have to look out over it. So I'm concerned about that also. I couldn't say enough about working with Home Depot and their willingness to do whatever it took to be able to be in the Lynnwood community. And I think that having them is, we should be very thankful. I know that I am to be able to have them there as a financial stability, plus what I think they're going to bring to the Lynnwood community. So that's a little bit on how the evolution of this project got to where it was. And as far as the apartments, we've developed in a lot of areas. We've developed in Redmond, we've developed in the U District, and I scoured, you know, West Seattle and Green Lake and Redmond and up by Microsoft where a lot of activity is going on. This project will compare to anything in any of those markets because this 405 corridor now is kind of connected. You know, there's no real difference now between going down to Bothell or going to Woodinville, getting into Kirkland and all that. So I know that we'll have the best project in the North End. The materials here, we've worked very closely with Todd and Ashley. Those development standards, I mean, they're no big deal to us because we're already doing it. I mean, we're bringing that kind of attention to detail. And so it's hard to always see that in elevation. One of the things about these elevations, you look at them and you say, well, what's the big gray thing in the bottom? Well, that's a 2-story parking garage that you'll never see. We're able to take the residential right from the street up, which will be a much better look in the locations that are at than having to look at empty commercial space where it isn't practical. What we're really focused is on that access drive. We've left spaces there to activate that street for the restaurants. If you look at the landscape plan in that handout, we've done an amphitheater down there. We've done a raised, kind of a performance area down there. Our idea is to, like Councilmember Sessions had said, is we want to activate. We want people to have a place to go. But we're really surrounded by parking lots out there. So what we're going to be bringing with the landscaping and the type of tenants, I mean, there's tenants like Flatstick, you know, which for the young people, they love going there. It's got the indoor, you know, putting miniature golf in there and shuffleboards and all that stuff. They're interested in going in this space. So we're really kind of trying to be a little bit of the entertainment center. But the fact of the matter is the one big entertainment group that says a D and a B in it, wanted one building and 400 parking stalls, surface, no underground parking, no nothing. I mean, that was what the alternatives were to what we were able to provide here. So it's a little bit, you have to look at what the market is doing right now. And I think as a developer of this property, you'll be proud of it when it's all done. It's something as a snow station, you know, people are worried about it. Now people love it up there. Mill Creek Town Center, we got a lot of flack on that. Now people love that. So I think if you give us the opportunity to build this, I think you'll be very proud and you'll be extremely proud of the quality. So I've just handed this out just more for clarification. Most of the stuff's already in your packet, but I think the elevation, especially with the amount of windows and glass and getting rid of the parking would be more helpful. So that's all I have.
All right. We'll do questions in a bit here. Is there someone?
Turn it over to Scott Marmer from Home Depot.
Yes, I do, for Home Depot. Thank you.
I haven't got used to sitting down on a presentation yet. I have it.
Okay, good.
I was sneaky, wasn't I?
Yes, you were.
And I do thank you, Beth, for getting this PowerPoint up there. My name is Scott Mulmer. I'm a site development coordinator for Home Depot. I've been doing it for about 25 years now with a consulting firm who does it for Home Depot. Tonight with me, I have Kim Cohen from Home Depot. She's the senior real estate manager out of Atlanta who's overseeing this project. I think, as Steve indicated, over the last 14 months, a a lot of hard work and hard effort got into this project to get it where it is tonight to be before you, and I thank staff for all their work and support to get us here tonight. And with that, I have a small presentation to give regarding the project. And I click. It was a pretty interesting night to hear all the events and everything going on, and really enjoyed hearing all that. And 60 years, wow, that's pretty good. You take my whole presentation away. Running through what was previously mentioned about the project, the Home Depot, obviously don't need to get into the map of where it's at, because I guess when you say Costco at the mall, everybody knows where it's at, the previous school site. With this project, as indicated, the parking for it, there was no variance. The parking that you see proposed for it is actually also required upon us to meet a parking demand by Costco. They have a what we call a REA over the whole entire property that dictates certain things that we can and cannot do on the property, and one is parking. So the parking is an aggregate of 415 stalls with approximately 207 on the bottom and 208 on the roof for the total of 415 stalls. With the design of this project, the road going through it was designed with the guidelines of the city to be pedestrian friendly. We have unique lighting for the street lights going through there, so they don't match the shopping center light. They're special for the street, along with the bollard pedestrian lighting to make it pedestrian friendly as you go through the street. And then as it curves down, it lines up with the Costco driveway to create that continuity between the two projects. The signage for the project, actually, let me do this. I have extra.
Very smart. Thank you.
Thank you, Scott.
And I brought three flash drives.
Maybe we need to try a different flash drive.
So on the handout was the similar rendering that you saw earlier. It's just been freshed up to be the current site layout with the parking lot. As indicated by staff, the building out front, that's within, per se, the Home Depot parking lot, but it's Wakefield's development, so it's not Home Depot's outlot. So Wakefield will be controlling how that will ultimately be developed. I think we've been through the site plan. The renderings are just fresh. refresh on this one as opposed to the one that you saw previously to indicate the new site layout. We, as Home Depot, attempted to do a view of the access road. We acquired Steve's elevation and then showed the road going through there. And you can see the unique old-fashioned street lights, like just past that little white car here. So those will be throughout that area there. So this kind of gives you a snapshot. And you can see Costco in the background there. So it was an attempt at our rendering of the street showing the apartments. Then we have the various elevations of the Home Depot along with signage. One thing with signage that's part of the DA is rather than have a monument sign for Wakefield, one for Home Depot, we have a joint one. So we have the Home Depot, and then these panels over here are for Wakefield to put in as they see fit for their retail, restaurants, and so forth. So that's combining rather than have separate signs on each side of the street. So we think that's a big plus for the project. The Home Depot, I think there was questions asked about the, what Home Depot does or what Home Depot provides. Home Depot, gives back to the community. It gives back overall to veterans and various other agencies. This store would probably employ about 150 to 200 employees. One thing about Home Depot, a lot of people start at Home Depot picking up the carts in the parking lot, going to school, and end up going through the whole program, end up being regional managers. It's phenomenal. In the 25 years that I've been doing this, how I'll come across a regional manager or a senior VP, and they started off pushing the carts into the store. So that's one thing about Home Depot and how you can grow with Home Depot as an employee. With Home Depot, this site was selected based on the demographics. But also where we are located on various other cities surrounding Lynnwood, and we're like, bing, this is equal to all the other to get those sales here versus going off to the other stores. Home Depot does have online sales. I know some communities are concerned about that. Where does that tax base go? Typically about 6.7% of on-site online sales are actually picked up at the store versus being delivered to a customer. So this site, I think, as I previously mentioned, it was designed with the pedestrian friendly to go through it as you dive into the site plan. We actually have spots on both sides of the road for benches for people to sit down as they stroll through this area. So it is set up to be pedestrian friendly between the two projects. Obviously, one of the questions came up, stormwater management. Won't dive into that, but we definitely have the stormwater management. Home Depot is committed, as they are in every community. And the way it typically works or does work for Home Depot is that we have our veterans and disaster and training and so forth, but also each store, the manager is the person who controls what he does in the community. So he's given a certain amount of his sales for giving back to the community. So he's the one who ends up participating with the community. And you have to remember, because I just had this happen on another project, you know, why can't we get this, or why another one, why can't we get that? So the way it works is you actually apply for something from Home Depot, and then it's processed by the store, and then they give back, and then it's rotated. It always just can't be one certain entity or whatever. It's rotated, and each store manager works with the community to give back. I think related to the green and so forth, a question came up about this project for LEED. So we're going to demonstrate that we're going to be a LEED certified. So what we represented in the DA was a checklist that utilized for LEED certified. So we had our architects and special LEED person go through and evaluate this store. So I believe we came up with like 40 points and we need 36. I don't remember the exact number offhand. But one thing I'd like to say about Home Depot, back in the 2008, 2009, Home Depot, along with two other big box, participated with the federal government on experimenting with new stores, energy consumption, and products. So what you see out there today in offices and businesses was all part of this federal investigation of what can be used, what works, what doesn't work. So, you know, applaud the Home Depot for being part of that. It's not something that's advertised or told day in, day out, but that's how we got where we are. So maybe the elephant in the room, the roof. So Home Depot is a business, and to be able to utilize the roof, it would it's a whole different liability. It's a whole different insurance, associates, man hours, and so forth to be able to utilize the roof for something that Home Depot just can't come out and say, yes, we're going to do this on the roof. I think Steve mentioned he's going to have a amphitheater part of his project to be able to have movies and so forth there. So, you know, there is that component there. But just to put out there that Home Depot has its own liability by doing that. And then do you start putting up, you know, 8-foot fences on the roof, you know, so, you know, somebody doesn't jump off, and you know, it just goes on and on. So it's a really difficult thing to commit to, and I just wanted to get that out there. I'd be happy to answer any questions if you have any.
So let me, I think that we have one more partner speaker with the school district, or no? Is it? Yes, we do.
We have the property owner, probably the most important speaker tonight.
I know, so I think we should hear from Lydia Selly at this point, and then we can move into some questions. You'll get all our presentations.
So I also signed up for public comment, so I'm imagining this will replace so I won't have to speak twice.
Oh, there you go.
I'm Lydia Sully. I'm the Executive Director of Business and Finance at the Edmond School District. I'm relatively new to this position, so I have been learning about this project, got very excited. So I am speaking on behalf of the Edmond School District in support of the project. I'm asking you to please approve the agreement this evening and congratulate you on your 60th anniversary. Edmonds acquired this property 59 years ago, so we are right behind you. It fits in with our vision of what we see as a good community partnership with all players and beneficial to the community as a whole. I have put my thoughts down in writing, which I will provide copies to all of you, and if you have any questions of me, I will be available. Otherwise, I will just hand out the copies that I have crafted.
Okay. Well, we'll take your copies.
Thank you for your time.
So I think I have to continue with public comments. So I want to ask at this point, is there anyone in the audience who would like to speak this evening? Okay, let me get... Let's see. Rosa Antoine, why don't you start?
She didn't hear you.
Oh, Rosa, do you want to start? I'm sorry.
A little hard of hearing.
It's all right, me too.
Rosa Antoine, 19501 40th Avenue West. I've been looking at that big open space there near Costco since I moved up here, wondering, what are they going to put there? And I'm excited to hear that there's going to be more housing, but I wasn't very happy with the response to George Hurst's question about low-income housing. In this day and age, it should be mandated by any city, I think, that anybody that builds anything should have a part of them, at least, to be for low-income housing. People are hurting all over. The prices of everything goes up all the time, and most people don't keep up with their wages, the average person, you know. And when you live on a limited income, of course, as a senior, it does limit what you can do. So I would ask that there be some consideration going into this, that there be some of these places be dedicated for low income. Thank you.
Maria Ambacombi? Your name is not Maria.
She called Maria, darling. Oh. Margaret.
Nice try. Nice try, Annie. Nice try.
Maria Abercrombie, 19501 40th Avenue West. In listening to all of this, maybe I'm misinterpreting, but I've heard the term family. You know, multi-family unit. And when I think of family, I think of a mother, father, some children. I don't know, maybe that's just a construction term that's used to mean a box where somebody lives in. I'm 66 years old, I live by myself. Is where I live, is that considered a family unit? So it concerns me when the word family is brought into this. It makes it sound like, oh, we're going to have families, and yet I don't see a playground for children. I don't see where this, within this construction, there's some culture or provision for cultural development for our children, for the future. Our children are our future. What are we providing in this space for them? And it has so many possibilities. Home Depot gee, I mean, that's so limitless. You could work with the school district. It's right there. You have all the lumber, all the tools. Make a workshop, work with the buildings, have the children, have the kids from the high school bust over. That'd be their vocational training for skills. And those are real skills that they could use in real jobs to help build this community. And I'm not so sure how many carts you would have to push to make it up to CEO of Home Depot. So, you know, as a council, I ask you, what is your real vision? Are you going to have families come in, or what are you doing to attract those families? The fact that the low-income housing will not be there for them. We all know the demographics of that, you know, other areas. Who are you really calling here if you're not going to have that low-income provided 20% or 30%, whatever would be required, or whatever the city could require of that development? That eliminates a lot of people, and that will determine the demographics of that area. We all know the outcome of that. A lot of cities have gone that route. So as a city council, I ask you, is this consistent with your vision? Maybe it is. Maybe we just don't really know what your vision is. Thank you.
Thank you. And Ted Heichel?
Oh. It only took me 20 minutes to figure it out.
All right, Mr. Heichel.
Ted Heichel, 3820, 191st Place, Southwest Lynnwood. The community development director may approve. The community development director may grant deviations. The director may deviate from this standard. I guess that's the answer to question number 4. The project is eligible for an administrative parking reduction. We don't need that many parking spaces. We didn't at the Shag. 0.9 for every senior apartment that's going into that. Oh, but it didn't work out. How is a 15% reduction in the number of car spaces that you have at a big apartment project, and I'm not sure, is it 500 units or is it 545? I saw the number 545 on the information that's up on the website, your website. 500, you're going to have 876 spaces, which is down to like 1.7, and this obviously is not for families. It's called multifamily because it's a term we use for anything that's an apartment complex. You're going to have single people coming in, married couples, both of them working in different directions, needing 2 parking spaces per, and you're going to be short of parking spaces again. So I appreciate the lady who said, what's your vision? Is this it? Already on 184th, trying to get into Costco, the turn lane that is there is already overloaded much of the time. The parking lot is almost full a lot of the time we go there, and we park out in the boonies. You're going to have another entrance into this project coming off of the Ring Road that's going to further back up the traffic on 184th. You do have an alternate, but that also is the alternate to go into Home Depot. And it states in here that there was no previous value to the property, so it's at zero. Well, when I was here a few years back, we had a terrific athletic complex there that the whole community could use. We lost that because the school district wanted to make money off of it, and these companies who want to come in, and I don't have any problem with them coming in, but they want to make money off of this property too. We lost something big. And I hope I don't go over 3 minutes, but I noticed other people were given carte blanche as to how long they talked. 75%, I love Home Depot. I shop there. I go down to Aurora Village to do it. And it would be nice to have one here. But 95% of the people, I would bet, who work at Home Depot never become regional managers. Maybe that's too low a figure. Maybe it's more like 99. But there is obviously in an organization moving up. But the question too is, what are the wages? When those kids from high school come around, are they going to make $15 an hour? Are they going to make state minimum wage? So there are a lot of things that happen when you put in a big development like this. Parking, more low cost, wage, low wage jobs. And if I read this correctly, and I'm not sure I do, it looks to me like there is no real open space, no grass, no, there are a bunch of trees that are built around the edges of all the buildings in the apartment area. And there's some kind of a big, I take it it's like a paved area or brick courtyard type thing. But that is not where children are going to play. I don't think you're going to have many children in this. And the other thing that was on the confusing to me on the information that was put up on the screen is, are these single bedroom apartments? Are they two bedroom apartments? Are there some three bedroom apartments? You've got to judge things like parking based on that. And the other thing you have to judge is with 1,000 new people moving into these apartments, how many police officers are you going to have? When you get 1,000 people in, the standard that I grew up with, that I believe is still in effect, you have to have 2 new police officers for every 1,000 people you add to your community. We've not done that in the last how many years? Since 2008. We need to get better at some of these figures and some of the things that the people in the audience are bringing up to you as to what is your vision? What is your vision? Because it's going to be here for 30, 40, maybe 50 years.
Annie Lyman.
Thank you, Mayor. Thanks. So 1951 40th Avenue. And I moved here because I knew Lynnwood was well-developed. Parks, wonderful parks, just access to so many things, great arts council, really creative. I think you guys have had a vision. This is not a vision, I have to say. One little example, look at Everett. Everett was a cool town, and then there was the Casino Road. They had to bring all those people that wanted to work at the aerospace and all that, and they provided all that fast housing with little other development around. And they've had nothing but a mess. Everett has nothing but a mess with that casino area because they didn't think about planning provisions. It's like all these rats living in a maze. No place for them to go, no place to play. Crime is huge. So please don't do this. Thank you.
Are there others who'd like to speak? Van Abishan.
Van Abishan, 98036. Thank you, Madam Mayor, members of council. There was one council member left that was on the same council that I was on back at when the original Lynnwood Place was codified in the city. And I'm glad to see that this one has some of the features that we talked about then. too, I'm really concerned about the fact that there seems to be a lot less green space. The golf course, the miniature golf course, that's central and indoor thing, because it says there's a metal structure above it. If that's enclosed, then that's not really green space. And also, that must be in the area where the retention pond used to be. So I assume then that the retention pond is going to be covered over, filled in, used. I don't see it on here. Maybe I'm missing something. But we got beat up really bad in 2012 over that feature on the site because of the stormwater requirements. So I'm concerned about that. I also share Mr. Heichel's concern, and this will be the second time that I've posed this to this council, and that is, what are we going to do about the place protection for these additional 500 housing units? 1,000 people, hopefully, will occupy those, but they're still going to require police protection and police services. So again, I'm asking the council, where's your plan? Where's the plan for the additional police? Where's the plan for where are the additional police that we in general that we need? As Mr. Heichel pointed out, we're going on over 10 years of not really growing the police department, and we've got issues, major issues, according to some studies, with a crime in this city. So, again, I ask you, where's your plan for that? And with that, I'll thank you, and I'm glad to see that some of the features were saved over. I have to give a tip of the hat to the new folks that have come along. But we really do need to do something about some green space. Thanks.
Would anyone else like to speak this evening? All right, so I think that probably Steve, Scott, and Lydia should come to the table so that you're prepared to answer questions instead of jumping up and down, unless you have an alternate who you want to represent you. And then just make sure that when you're answering a question that your microphone is on that little red light. All right. So at this point, city staff and Stephen, Scott, and Lydia, would you like to offer any clarifying information in response to the citizen testimony provided this evening? Director Kleitch, do you want to kick that off or not?
I will wait to hear questions from council.
Did I miss a thing? Okay, so we had members of the audience to speak. Members of the audience. And then it is city staff to clarify the response to the citizen testimony. And then council gets to ask questions.
I have no clarification.
Okay.
Well, questions or statements?
Any other clarifications for public statements?
I'd like to clarify on the question about the stormwater.
Okay.
So there is currently a temporary pond. It's located on the north end of the site as you drive down that Costco, that private drive. So what that is that's handling water from 33rd. 184th, and not a lot of drain comes off the current site as it sits vacant, but we're going to be incorporating that stormwater detention in a vault underneath our parking garage. It'll sit at the base of that slab, and so we're at the same design guideline, the same amount of stormwater requirements that are currently in place now will just be changed into a vault that's designed for that. And then the access drive and will be handled by an open pond similar to what's on there right now that's in the corner of the, on the kind of the north, I guess it would be the northeast corner of that access drive as it goes down Costco. So that's how the stormwater. And then as far as green space, also building a sustainable project, and it's in the development agreement. You'll see there's two different type of sustainability requirements that we have. And a lot of our, we're building on a concrete slab, so we're starting with two levels of parking, because we basically the parking will be screened in those garages. And from there, then we're building up with planting gardens and taking the stormwater off the roofs and incorporating them into the, you know, all that open space. But there is a considerable amount of open space that we have there. And what we're trying to do is we're also trying to build recreational activity. So that becomes kind of people's backyard. And there are a lot of units there to create a backyard. So we have, you know, open, we have covered picnic areas. We have fire pit areas. We have a dog park that we're designing. We have about a 10,000 square foot recreational facility that will be for our tenants only. And also it will include, you know, a social area that will spill out into the open space area in the middle there. So that's about as efficient as we can provide, you know, 500 units in that space and still meet all the open space requirements. And that's why I paid special attention to provide that in the packet on the landscape plan. It's hard to read, but the city has a full-blown copy. I'd be happy to get anybody a copy of the full plan to read the details on that. But a lot of time and effort and study has gone into that. We just, you know, it's very important for us to provide a home for the residents, sir.
Thank you. Any other responses to public testimony? No? Okay. So at this point, council, it is your turn to ask questions to clarify information provided by public or the staff. Councilmember Sessions.
Thank you. Thank you for being here and talking to us finally. I've been asking about this for some time, and I know going back and forth without you face-to-face isn't as efficient. So thank you for being here. First, I just want to say with my comments, it's all due respect. Home Depot is, you know, an honorable business. I love that they help veterans and do things in the community. Steve, your development sounds beautiful, the apartments do, and the way you're trying to take advantage of the space you have and the quality, it's just not my vision. I mean, thank you for using that thing, and that's the problem, I guess. But I think you're selling yourself short, Steve, because did you say, and I heard this was a possibility before, but it wasn't mentioned, but in your corner of the property, is it the north? No, south?
The southeast corner of the building there?
Yeah. That's a restaurant with an amphitheater?
Yeah, what we're trying to build there is, and we haven't designed that building because we've got a stack of interested restaurants, and we're trying to pick the right one. I think we may end up having two there, but we designed that open space amphitheater to have the kind of the outdoor seating area to spill out into that. So on a Friday night, people can be sitting outside. We can maybe have local artists and stuff performing down there. So it's a lot of talk and discussion on that area there. But rather than trying to just rush into that and design it, we are trying to find, and like I said, I don't have a lack of really good opportunities to put there. And so that and that out parcel are the same thing. We want to pay special attention to that because that's all part of the activating that access drive.
And all open to the public?
Yeah, all open to the public.
And, I mean, I would say that would count as question number two. What are project amusement recreation uses and the retail shops? I mean,
I only have a little bit of area.
Still, don't sell yourself short. That's something.
Yeah. And then
also, don't require another amphitheater in the area like that.
The parking for that, those restaurant stuff will be basically at the same level. It'll be the top floor of our parking garage, so the signage will be pretty clear that that's where the parking is, and then they'll walk into that space and through the a corridor in the parking underneath the structure to the restaurant. So really, we're pretty much screening all the parking from it's just not a building and a surface parking.
Okay,
and we're providing that within the garage.
Thank you. And then the flat stick, I'm not familiar with that. So is that something open to the public or just special for your residents?
No, it's open. There's two of them in Seattle, and there's one. Councilman Cotton knows. There's one in Kirkland also. But it's just a gathering place for young people. It's what it is. And
open to the public?
Open to the public, right.
another option here, you're selling yourself short.
I'm sorry, I should have.
So start bragging about that. And then...
Okay, can I brag? Because that 2030 vision you guys had at the workshop, we won the 2020 vision on that back then, so...
Okay, good job. I really do wish this looked more like the Mill Creek Town Center, where your other apartments are. I understand, I hear what you're saying about the financial side of it. I just know that other communities are still being creative, even with the problems of online retail sales. They're still being creative and doing cool things. I just hope that you guys will prove me wrong and do something very creative. As far as the apartments being market rate, to me, I mean, I know that we need, I know that it's popular to say that we need affordable housing, but I know Lynnwood has a lot of affordable housing, and I also know that we need all kinds of housing badly in Lynnwood, a variety of housing, so all kinds of housing. So I'm excited for all kinds of housing, so I appreciate that. If I could talk with Scott. Scott, thank you again. All respect to Home Depot. It's not sexy. Cody, you can quote me on that. Do you have any pull with Cracker Barrel? Because I think Cracker Barrel is pretty fun. To be in that restaurant space there.
That parcel is Steve, so...
Cracker Barrel, when you find out how many parking stalls there are on the surface, you won't want Cracker Barrel there. It's there. They
for
take
their
a lot of...
Yeah. Motorhomes and things?
Yeah.
Okay. I'm serious about that, though, but... and then, Scott. Thinking about, well, I'm not going to go on about the rooftop, I guess. I think summer concerts on the roof sound really cool, but there's not much I can say about that. I just wish it was different. All due respect to the good Home Depot. Then, let's see. I think that's it for now. I'll let somebody else speak if I think of something else. Thank you.
Councilmember Hurst.
Great, thank you. Question on the Wakefield property. The 500 units, so how is that going to be divided? Do you know as far as one bedroom, two bedroom?
Yeah, it's all in our application, stuff like that. I don't have it. But it's divided between efficiency units, one bedroom, two bedroom, one bath, two bedroom, two baths. Three bedrooms. I don't know if it's in this particular one, but in our PDR application that we have at the city.
No, it's in small print here.
Yeah, no, that wasn't designed. I figured, I don't know how much information you guys get before the meetings.
Okay. No, that's great. I know it's popular to say from this dais that Lynnwood has lots of affordable housing, but really, according to the Snohomish Housing Consortium, we're short 2,000 to 3,000 units. So I think part of our vision has to include that. But I agree, we need to have all kinds of housing, and I think that's something that this council needs to take up real soon. And then as far as the, so I was trying to figure out, where is the amphitheater? I was trying to find that.
If you look, that's particular, it's like across the hall, the right building that's kind of illustrated there on the other side of the street, in front of our, it's kind of our leasing area also. We have a business center there. So it's about midway on the west side of the access drive.
Okay.
You'll see kind of the stair steps down, and there's different views of it, no sheets, any landscape plans.
All right.
Yeah, it's right there in the dark area. I have to clarify for Scott, it really wasn't designed for movies. There may be an opportunity for that, but it was maybe more designed for outdoor concerts and those kind of activities.
Right here.
Yeah, right there.
Okay. And then on the whole handout, and this is probably going to be to Mr. Hall, the signage, does that all comply with current sign ordinance, or are we...
Yeah, I can clarify on that. So the signage that was presented in the PowerPoint presentation, specifically with regards to the pole sign, we do not allow pole signs in this location, and we, Kirk Rappi, planner, and I have spoken with the signage company that was hired by Home Depot, and they're fully aware of the types of ground and monument signage, so the one that's represented in this particular slide is incorrect, so yeah, that's resolved.
Okay, didn't know we had done a change or not. And I think that's it for my scribbling, so yeah, we're good.
Councilmember Cotton.
Thank you. Look out, gentlemen, I'm an engineer, so I apologize ahead of time. The total number of units, we're looking at the cover page here, the A000. It says your net units is 503, but when I add up the four buildings count, it's 508.
It should be 500. Our architect sometimes shows 503, and he's maybe we need to have an engineer do the math, but it's 500 units.
500 units is your net, okay. And then when I look up the composition of the units, I counted only about 46 three-bedroom units. Is it from your market experience, what constitutes the modern family that's renting from your properties these days? Do you?
Well, I can't really speak for necessarily for I don't know the term modern family, but you know, usually in a project like this, like if you go to Redmond or Bellevue or something, you very rarely find three bedrooms. In fact, our average square footage is about 888 square feet. If you go to any project in Redmond, our average is about 730 square feet. And the reason ours goes up is we're trying to provide the three bedroom units, because you don't have to go very far north and you'll see a higher percentage of that. But this is what they call the urban suburban, and you find more people that you're going to find a lot of singles that want to live here, couples that take the bus and eventually let the building for a long while. And so three bedrooms just become, I think what happens too is the average, you get up the rents to the point where you could buy a house, and you know, and so it's just a marketing people would kind of research around and find that there's a three bedroom market, but it's limited, and so you don't want to overbuild and just have them sit there. You gotta have them, you know, fall and meet the market demand, which is more than small units.
Okay.
I think Director Kleitch would like to add to that.
Very good. Thank you. Director Kleitch, please.
Thank you, Mayor, members of Council. 500 is capped environmentally.
Okay.
So through their environmental impact statement, that was 500 that was identified in there, so it's not over 500.
Okay. Excellent. And just from the site improvement standpoint, it had been mentioned only a couple times, and we've kind of, I think, skipped over it. There's the connection between this property and the inner urban. Is that specifically driven largely by this residential build-out and the desire to create that multimodal connection?
Yeah, we were, that was part of the ERS and the improvements that were required, and it's more, we feel like that's more the residential units or the tenants that are going to be using that trail than probably somebody shopping at Home Depot. So that's kind of the development agreement is written when you're getting that trail to our permit versus Home Depot.
Okay. No, it's going to be humping a bunch of 2x4s over their shoulders?
That's what Home Depot told me.
Some bicycle trailers, maybe. Get set up.
If I may, that also goes back to the original EIS.
Okay.
Because the sidewalk around 33rd was made wider so people could come down out of the neighborhoods, and people that lived at this property in housing could then connect right to the trail.
Okay.
So that's why that sidewalk's wider, and that's why this is the last piece to connect it up to the trail.
Thank you. And then lastly, just to tie in on the rooftop parking alternative uses discussion. It's an open air parking, but would using this, even under some kind of temporary use permit or however that mechanism is, would using the rooftop of should Home Depot decide that they wanted to rent out or make available to for some kind of community event the rooftop, would it trigger some kind of additional space uses where it wouldn't just be a parking lot or would be an assembly type occupancy? I mean, but it's outside, so I don't know what that, how does that work, or do you know? I know it's kind of a...
We build the type in, whether or not it would require some other type of design, I would have to check with the architect unless staff knows.
Does anybody staff know what that, like, it's outdoor parking, so is it even feasible? Okay, maybe it's a, I know it's a little bit of a hot seat question, so. And then you'd mentioned a flat stick or a tenant-like flat stick being, is that the southeast tenant, the one kind of right off
of the... Todd, I don't know if you can pull the site plan back up. Yeah, if you look at, there's one that shows the commercial space. I don't know if you have it, but anyway, it's a, if you look at the middle drive that acts, it goes west, that did go west.
You went way too far west.
Is it the one kind of right in the middle of the property?
So if you go in the middle, yeah, if you're driving, the one's just to the north, there's about a 14,000, 15,000 square foot area.
Okay.
Yeah, the other way, towards the Costco. So right up there, it's kind of L-shaped.
Yes.
Right there. So in that, we've actually been approached by the broker and combining that with the restaurant user, I guess, that they tie in with. And we love the idea. And it fits with what we're trying to do all around there with all of those tenants that we have there. You just have to balance out the parking lot because there's just big parking users. And it's just going to be a combination of, hopefully we can get the restaurants in there. But along the Costco side up there will probably be more of service-oriented. They're facing that way just because there's not really a lot of activation going on out there. There's screening and stuff. But all that whole area there, too, as you go wrap around the corner, that's all glass. When you drive down, there's going to be a real streetscape. So we kind of get the best of both worlds. We get the commercial feel as you drive down the access drive. But if you go up to Vancouver, where I spent up at the U.S. office for the largest multifamily builder up there, they build the residential from the ground up. You very rarely see the commercial tucked underneath it. And a lot of times it's vacant if it's not in the right location. Here we have a great opportunity because of the anchors around it. Yeah. I think we're matching the best of both worlds. We get the commercial feel, but when you're living there, you feel like you're in a residential unit, not just above the commercial space there. So.
Okay. And could you just briefly maybe elaborate or summarize the kind of the list of amenities that, because you've kind of mentioned dog park and open space and fire pit and some kind of indoor amenity. Could you maybe kind of elaborate, like, is it kind of a gym, community kitchen?
All of the things you just said. It's, so if you go down to the, starting at 184th, there's where our dog park is. We're still trying to figure out if we can open that up to the public. Most people are walking around there. It's just, it's a management thing. We just started, we're doing our first one up in Marysville right now.
Okay.
And, but then as you go there, you got a lot of waste planning areas, a lot of kind of sitting areas, and then we get into more of the, areas where you can have the picnic area gathering. We want to be able to have maybe multiple events going on at one time. So if someone's using the rec building, some are not blocked off from having other events. And so things like cornhole toss and miniature golf, and that's not just, that's trying to make a signature out of this, that area there to make it really, but it have a lot of activities. And we're going to have kids there, so we're going to have play areas that we're going to have the tot lots and stuff. That's kind of a city requirement anyway. So it's just, you got people living above it, so they have to pay special special attention to the noise and that kind of thing. But I think our landscape architect, Tom Weisdorf, did a fantastic job around this out. So I think we packed about as much activity as we can and balancing out the green space and the plantings and all that. Because you want to soften that hardscape that you have there.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you. That's all the questions for me. Thank you all for taking the hot seat.
Council, any other questions? Yes, Councilmember Hurst.
Just one last. In the Home Depot PowerPoint or handout, the project schedule, is that still doable, where you're going to be grand opening on November 5th, 2020? I'll stand there for you. And then also for the... I'm confused. So it says Lynnwood Place Phase 1. I thought we were talking Phase 2. But are you going to be done by June 21?
Yeah, we're looking. I'll let Scott speak to him a little bit. I think a lot of this depends on when tonight goes also with our schedule. But our plan is to build our whole garage at the same time and then the first two buildings. The first phase, what we call Building 1 and 2, which are the southernmost buildings, it's about a 24-month build. And then we'll hope to build around as we finish up buildings. So it'll just minimize the impact of especially the Home Depot and the construction going on, and we're really trying to look at the most efficient way of doing that. Because that's a big garage that we have going up there, and it's going to take a while. But our plan is to stay, I think we're talking to stay around the middle of July. They might even be able to start earlier.
Our objective is to start earlier. The schedule up here tonight is actually what we presented to the real estate committee. So that's our GO that we have to make. So we'd like to make a GO grand opening sooner than that one. We'd like to start construction as soon as we can to get through grading before the bad weather comes in.
Okay. I'm going to just make one. I know developers don't have the best rap, but the amount of work that it goes into pulling off a development like this to get the capital and people like Home Depot and get everything, the permits, work all stuff. I mean, it's a lot of work, and it's all kind of like that right now. I think for the school district standpoint, I've worked with Home Depot a lot about our schedule around it, and so I would just make that a special emphasis that if you like what you see, I mean, now's a good time. It takes a long time to regroup and start again and all that stuff, so I just, it takes a village to pull these things off.
Council, anything else? Okay, one more.
One more first. For Director Kleiss. So we have all these projects going on, and I know we're hiring people. How are we doing staff-wise to be able to facilitate, really what is aggressive as far as Home Depot?
Well, we... as you know, are going through changes in DBS, all for the good. We have a new building official, very efficiency and effectiveness oriented. And right now, we are hiring staff up, but we're also contracting now. So I think that we're in good shape to handle it in the interim. Ultimately, the goal is to staff up, not have contracts, but in the interim with contracts, we'll be fine.
Council, anything else? One more? All right, then at this time, since all citizens wishing to speak have had an opportunity to do so, and since City Council's had the opportunity to ask questions regarding the testimony provided, it's appropriate to close the public comment portion of this hearing. Unless the council wishes to take action to keep the hearing open or to continue the hearing to a future meeting, the hearing should be considered closed. And audience, I thank you again for being here tonight. So at this point, I would invite the council to make a motion and begin discussion and deliberation. Councilmember Cotton.
at 3337. Mm-hmm. All right. I move ordinance number 3337, an ordinance of the City of Lynnwood, Washington, adopting the Lynnwood Place Project Phase 2 Development Agreement as development regulations for the Lynnwood Place site and providing for severability and effective date and summary publication.
Second.
And would you like to speak to that?
I would. I understand that this, you know, I was in the audience when I first saw this Phase 2, and it was very much more the Mill Creek Town Center. And I was very excited about that. I also know that times change and that the landscape of what is economically viable changes with that. I'm excited about the Home Depot coming in because it is a good mid-range shop. It's not office white-collar work, but it is definitely a step up the ladder, and it's something, you know, kind of, I think, a step above service level kind of employment. I'm excited about the housing coming in because understanding market pressures, I think, as we, there's two ways to create affordable housing in my mind. One way is to create incentive and subsidies, and the other way is to make sure that the market can produce the housing so that the laws of supply and demand can also make the housing more affordable. So I think that this, while we talk about doing the first with policy, I think that we can also help speed along bringing more housing online, which will help with the demand equation. So I'm excited about this. You know, in a perfect world, you know, I'd love to see some 30-story buildings down there, but I also know that Lynnwood's not there yet. We're getting there. So I think this is a step in the right direction, so I'm in support of this. Thank you.
Council President?
Thank you. Before I start my comments, I will very reluctantly... I'll move up a little bit because it's on. I will very reluctantly move to extend to the end of item 100, new business.
Second.
All those in favor, please say aye.
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 Any opposition? Thank you, Council President.
Thank you. I as well am quite excited about this. I've been passing by an empty property for several years now, and I know it's not a bad property. Actually, it's a very good property. I think the problem is that what we had as a vision before is not something that will work now. Otherwise, we would have a number of people that would say we want to do just what we had planned previous. And I think what is being proposed now will work very well. I think if they decided to put a water park in, someone would say that's too much water use. If they decided to put sand volleyball courts, that's too much sand, we can't do that. We're not going to be able to make every single person happy with what goes in as a development. And I think that this is something that we can have in the area because I think it fits very well. You know, using that as a huge recreation area now would seem kind of odd when you have Costco on one side and the mall on the other. But having a mixed use where you also have those amenities, where you have a amphitheater, where you have a dog park, and whether or not that's open to the public, the people that live in that area and rent from or own or however it's set up to live in those areas will want those spaces for their pets. And I think that is very beneficial. And if you go up the street, up 184th, yes, it's a big hill, great exercise. When you get to the top of that, you have Pioneer Park. So there's green space in the area as well. So I don't think that there is anything, at least in my view, that would be detrimental to the city. I think all of the things that we're presented with will benefit not only the city, they'll benefit the school district and benefit people that are coming to live in Lynnwood, and especially as was mentioned with light rail coming, you know, we're going to need more area, more livable area, and I think that's going to contribute to that very well. So I will definitely be supporting this project. So thank you very much.
Councilmember Hurst, did you give me the sign? Okay, yes. Councilmember Hurst.
Thank you. Yeah, it's not a project to jump up and down about, but let's face it, it's we have one big gray box store way in the back, and we just have a nice orange one towards the front. And now the concern really is, it, for me, is the housing, and you know, we as a council need we need to figure out what our vision is and put it into policy, and we really need to look at housing. And I know our staff is creating a white paper, but I would say that this housing policy needs to be driven by council. We need to somehow do a roundtable. We need to get to it. But I think this project fits into the area that it's there. If we were plucking this thing down on the city center, I don't think it would work. But we, you know, it's next to a mall. It's next to a Costco, and I think it's got some good amenities, and look forward to seeing it built, because, yeah, it's been an empty space for a long time. Thank you.
Any other council comments? Yeah, Councilmember Sessions?
Thank you. I think these are going to be beautiful apartments, and I don't see a problem with that. But how to be creative with that space, with the multi-use. I understand the Home Depot, but I just don't love it. I more than don't love it. I really wish we could have done something different here. And just out of principle, I mean, with all due respect, I'm going to have to vote no, knowing that that's not going to stop anything from happening, which is good. But I just want to be proved wrong. The retail and mixed use and the amphitheater and the hopefully a variety of restaurants, sidewalk cafe type thing maybe that can be done there would be worth it. It would be really cool. And I just hope that can happen. I think it will. I think there will be some fun things that will be able to go in there, and you'll prove me wrong, and that will be great. Thank you. For all due respect to all of you, thank you for doing this and your hard work.
Any other council comments?
Okay.
Okay. We'll do the roll call vote, please.
Council Vice President Brazil?
Yes.
Council President Goodwin?
With all due respect, yes.
Councilmember Hurst?
Yes.
Councilmember Ross?
Yes.
Councilmember Sessions?
No.
Councilmember Sutton?
Yes.
Councilmember Cotton?
Affirmative.
6 yes, 1 no.
Thank you. Ordinance number 337 passes 6-7. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Also, what did I just say?
Thanks for the dialogue. I've never been able to do this before. That's really, 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 I appreciate it.
Thank you. All right, Council, we do not have an executive session. Is there any new business that needs to come forward? No? Motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Second.
And all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Thank you.